everybody. May 10th, 2019, live from the Troy Lee Design Saloon in Corona, California. It's the Whiskey Throttle Show. Thanks for joining us. Yeah, make some noise. All right. Tonight, we've got a pretty cool guest. We're excited about this. Factory Husqvarna rider and former 250 national champion, Dean Wilson, is with us. Dean Wheelspin, as he's been dubbed. We're pretty excited about having him up. Super fun guy. He's 50% Scottish, 50% Canadian, 50% American. Now, I don't know about how that math works out. I think there was something lost in the conversion from metric
No,
is that right?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. That's what I figured.
He's 150% man.
Yep.
I want to introduce my co-host, as always, Grant Langston. Give it up for GL, former national world supermoto champion, supercross champ. Got championships coming out your ears, man.
Not enough.
Never enough.
Yeah, divorce will do that to you.
Yeah.
Never enough championships. Meet our producer over here, DJ Donnie, on the computer pushing
What's up?
Buttons.
How you guys doing?
We just feed him bananas, and he just hits buttons over there and works out. Yeah. I want to introduce our sponsors to you guys. We've got some awesome sponsors on this show. PowerDot brings you Dean Wilson tonight. If you guys have not gone back and checked out our booth in the back, meet up with Bryce Valley. He can give you a little demonstration of how this thing works. It's an incredible tool for anybody, especially athletes, especially anyone who's, if you're racing motorcycles, you're going to get hurt. And this is an awesome tool to prevent it, to recover from it. But even for people that sit at a desk all day, it's got a massage feature. That's really all you need to know, right?
That's where I'm at
these
days.
That's what you do.
It's not for, you know, warm-up or that. It's usually just,
yeah,
you know, basics.
On the couch,
yeah,
with one of those, just chilling.
This is a personalized TLD red solo cup.
Yep.
Right there.
Yep. GL Special.
There you go.
Filled that's Cytomax.
What's in
he's
there?
Hydrating, yeah. Guys. Also want to thank Method Race Wheels. If you haven't checked out their Bronco back here, they bring in some type of trick vehicle at every live show, and it's this thing makes my nipples hard when it fires up. It's insane. That thing is insane. Check out Method Race Wheels. They sponsor our front-end chatter segment. Also, Decal Works. They provide us with all the logos that you see, all of the bikes, the project bikes we do at Racer X Online and Racer X Illustrated. These guys are awesome. They do great work. Check them out. Four Wheel Parts, Troy Lee Designs, Adidas Pro Circuit, Dunlop Tires, Nihilo Concepts. And I want to welcome a brand new partner of the show. GL and I are especially stoked on this one because we're picking up new bikes next week. Specialized Bicycles. You know, we really pride ourselves on partnering with the best companies in the business, period. And we don't just take whoever's writing the fattest check. It's the best companies, period. That's it. And there's just not a better bicycle company than Specialized. We're going to both pick up some Canovos. What is it? They make a Levo and a Canovo, a couple of e-bikes.
Yep.
And we're going to jump on that whole ship and have some fun on these bikes. And I'm sure you'll see some videos of us riding these things soon.
Yeah, I'm stoked. I'm not ready to go and crank hills anymore, so... That little electric power, just right up my alley, man.
Just keep her at 100% power and go. Yeah, that should be a lot of fun. Really stoked.
Popping wheelies up the hill. That's what I'm all about these days.
What are you going to do when the battery dies?
I just leave it in the hills and walk home.
Yeah, just walk home.
Just like when your practice bike seized back in the day. You lean up against the fence post, throw your hands up, and storm off.
I'm just factory, bro. I'll get a new one.
Yeah, I just see like a pile of bicycles left at a bunch of places.
No, that's the cool thing about it. The battery runs out. You just pedal it home. It's a little tougher, but you'll get there. I also want to thank RacerX Magazine. In the July issue, we find out who makes key decisions in the rule book, enforcing rules and rough riding. That's been a big subject this year, penalties and what happens. So we really dove into that and got to the bottom of it. You can only get these features if you buy the magazine or subscribe to the digital edition. So go there and check that out. Also, we got a feature on Monster Energy Pro Circuit Kawasaki and how they need to get back to their winning ways, what they need to do. Obviously, it looked like they were on the path to doing that this year. It didn't quite pan out the way they hoped.
No.
But check that out. That's an interesting feature. We also went deep on a Bob Oliver interview, who's a longtime industry person at Yamaha.
He just left Yamaha, correct? He's
retiring. Yeah,
yeah,
he's retiring. Bobo's been there a long, long time. The RacerX Inter-Am, and then Electric Assist Bicycle, Specialized, sponsoring the GNCC series now. And they do a very big electric bike race the night before the GNCC round. So these things are kind of taking the whole world by storm, these e-bikes. There's a big feature on it there. Check that out. All this and more exclusively in the July issue. You can get all that stuff right now if you get the digital edition, so check those guys out. Go to racerxonline.com/subscribe or just go to RacerX online. You can figure it out.
Yep.
We got a bunch of giveaways tonight, guys. We're going to have some kind of contest after the break. We're going to give a set of Method race wheels away. These are amazing wheels. If you looked at either the Bronco or some of the ones we have back here, it's an expensive gift that we're going to be giving out. We do one at every live show. Those guys are super rad. And so we'll get into that after the beer break. But I really want to thank those guys. We also got a whole bunch of T-shirts and hats. So we'll be asking some questions here later on. And we got a lot of crap. Probably just about everybody's here going home with something. So you'll be stoked. Also, one more announcement. Every single dollar that we raise from you guys coming here tonight to this live show goes to Road to Recovery. We've got a personal goal here at the show to give back about... Yeah, give it up. So our personal goal is to get them 25 grand by the end of the year. If you listen to the Jimmy Button show, he goes into just how much good that charity, that organization is doing in our sport. And, I mean, it's critical, man. There's guys like Weston Pike right now who would be in a rough, rough spot if it wasn't for these guys. Getting him back to the U.S., paying for a lot of that insurance stuff. I mean, he's got great insurance, and he's still paying so much money. So it's a tough situation for those guys when they have an accident like that.
Well, the thing, too, is guys like Wes and Pike are names that we know. They also help a lot of those people that haven't quite made it yet, yeah. You know, so that really need the help that didn't have that that name already. So,
yeah, that's right. And even like Blake Savage is another name. Yeah. He's a trainer, brother-in-law to Ken Roxon. He's ingrained in the industry, but you don't know that name too much probably. But he recently was paralyzed, and, I mean, he's in a bad situation, and they've helped him a lot. So they do so much good work. We want to help them out. There's a charity golf classic coming up for John Fontaine. Anybody knows Mandy Fontaine? She's the Honda PR gal. Awesome girl. Her father had a horrible accident. It's a bad deal. So anyway, there's a charity golf classic. Foursomes are $450. One player is $125. You can go to roadtorecovery.com and check that out. That's coming up. It's in Rancho California Golf Course. 6/19, 6/9/19. So June 9th. It's a Sunday.
It's also an off weekend.
If anybody's around, it is an off weekend. There's going to be lots of moto guys there golfing and supporting this cause. So come out and join them. Have a good time. We try to support the heck out of those guys. They do awesome work. So thank you to them. All right. Let's give some hats and shirts away, man. I got so much crap under here. Let's just do it. Let's get right into it. Let's get some stuff. We got this set of TLD gear to give away. I got hats. Oh, look what else I got. Signed copies of Mickey Diamond's book, Legends of the Road. Anybody read this? Anybody want to read this?
Yeah, we've got a few takers.
All right. Who's been, let's start this. Who's been to the most live shows here? Who's been to like every single live show? It's you, isn't it?
There's
one. How many? Three? Four? Four. All four.
All four.
How many? Four?
Yep.
All right. Gentlemen, come on up. Grab your books. Nice work. Thank you guys for supporting the show.
We
I really appreciate
it. We do have some regulars.
It. That's
we
signed on the inside of the cover there. And I haven't read yet, but I did keep a copy at home because I want to check it out. Mickey's a cool cat. How do we want to give these away? We got some Decal Works T-shirts. You want to see how far we can throw it?
Who likes green?
Yeah! That guy just got a shirt. Yeah! T-shirt cannon.
There we go.
All right.
Quick and easy.
Quick and easy.
I prefer
sorry,
the
guy
other
in the back.
Cannon.
It's not coming back there. Sorry, man. And throw my drink at you? all right, we're going to jump into our Method Race Wheels front end chatter. Method Race Wheels bringing you the toughest, lightest, fastest wheels in off-road. These guys have won more Baja championships than two Johnny Campbells.
Ooh.
Whew, so
that's
many.
That's amazing.
These guys, they just do it. It's for real. Their stuff is awesome. Check them out, methodracewheels.com. So we want to get into a couple things in our front end chatter. First of all, Supercross wrap-up. What a weird season, man. Like, it's been good. But the last two seasons, you could not predict what the heck was going to happen. I mean, who would have predicted Jason Anderson to win last year? And this year, any three of those champions. I mean, halfway through the season even, you would have said, nah, probably none of those three guys.
I think actually the one that surprises me the least is probably Ferrandis. He was solid all season. If you look at it, he seemed like he was the bridesmaid most of the time, got a lot of seconds, didn't quite have the starts, but came through and put himself in a position where Cincerello had to go to the last race and actually race, not just circulate and get the points. So, you know, for AC, that was obviously a real... I was watching, I was like, I felt for him. But I just know the sport. I've been on both sides of the fence. And
yeah, but you were usually the one winning, you dickhead. I was the guy in second.
Hey,
I know how he feels.
Okay, well, in 01, I felt that feeling. All right.
That's true. I didn't win. Yeah. It was a big problem for
everybody
me.
Everybody, play the smallest violin you can.
Oh, my God.
For
this was
right
terrible.
He only won 7 titles.
No, I should have. That was 6. But, you know, so for Ferranis, I really felt like, I mean, he was leading the race. At the end of the day, he earned it. I mean, AC did screw up. The reason I felt for him is it seemed like such a harmless mistake that ended up being catastrophic. Because when he got up, I looked, and right as Carmichael said it on the broadcast, I looked, I'm like, there's no way he can race back and fight for this championship. So it was like it was ended right there. And I think that's what sucked. If he could have got up and had to fight back and make a couple passes to win it, that would have been just perfect
TV. It would have been great, yeah.
Just how they would have scripted it.
And he might have been able to do it. I mean, he's got some
It would have really tested him, and I agree with you. I think he would have probably been able to pull it out, but it didn't happen. On the flip side, you know, with Faulkner, and then it was unfortunate. He was dominant. But at the same time, when you're young and you're enthusiastic and you're excited, you get yourself hurt in qualifying practice or during the week and things like that where sometimes you almost need someone to tell him, you're the man, not be the man. Like,
yeah,
just
chill
pump
out.
Your brakes. It only matters in the main. It doesn't matter if you win your heat. Doesn't matter if you're fastest in time practice. Just pump your brakes a little bit. And it's hard when athletes are always at that level to get them to do that. But
how many times did he fall in time practice? Did he fall?
Every time.
Yeah, every time.
Every weekend he crashed in practice.
Yeah. And that's pushing the limits. And it's okay in practice. We say that, but that's maybe a front-end tuck. But that old saying, eventually you're going to go down and something's going to twist, snap, break, dislocate.
Yeah,
it's racing.
I swung by Pro Circuit today on my way over here. And
you're a brave man.
Yeah,
I would have avoided it for a couple of weeks, for sure. Just email only, not even text.
You know what? Mitch was surprisingly calm, and I picked his brain about both of his guys. I said, hey, you know, everything okay over here? And he says, you know, with Faulkner, it was a bit of a roller coaster because it looked like he had this title wrapped up.
Yeah.
Then he gets hurt. We're thinking it's over. And then they had 2.5 weeks. And he said every single day they were doing therapy. They were down at Doc G's doing, you know, whatever therapy they could do. They had it drained. They had shots of different things put in it. And he said we got him, you know, we went out the day before they left for New York. He looked great. They're like, I think he's going to pull this off, you know. And he gets back there. Practice was so-so. And then he had a couple of moments. There was a rhythm lane. He said every time he tripled into this pocket, his knee would shift.
Yeah.
He's like, I can't do that. There's no way I can do that for, you know, 15 laps. So,
but he was doing all the rhythms.
He was doing it because Mitch said, look, you got to do it. I mean, it's like a second and a half a lap slower to not do it, so just you got to do it. They were trying to just coach him through like, hey, you can't go out there and half-ass it. That's only going to hurt you more. If you want this title, you're going to have to race for it.
Yeah.
He did, and once he kind of jumped out on that flat and that one thing, it killed him. So anyway, roller coaster for him. And then as far as seeing Cirillo, you know, again, Mitch said, man, we were just sort of like, all of us were stunned because it seemed like he had things under control. He was doing what he needed to do.
It wasn't even a pressure mistake. It wasn't.
No, he said Roczen came over after the race and said that in that section, when you kind of doubled in, he said there was a funny little rut that your wheel would kind of pop into one right or the other.
And you see him do that.
And he said his wheel kind of snapped right then left, and it caught the tough block.
Just with the fork leg, just barely.
And Roczen said, you know what? It almost happened to me, the same thing in the main event. And he goes, I thought, oh, that's what Adam did. Like, I need to make sure I pay more attention right here. So, you know, we've talked about before, nothing is – you can say, oh, Adam deserved that title. There's nothing deserved in this sport.
No.
It is something that is just so brutal about it. You can be the fastest guy, the best guy, the whatever. You have to have the most points at the end of the series, right?
But on GL's point, like, Ferrandis really caught fire at the last four races. I mean, he really showed a lot of speed.
He had speed the whole time. His weakness was his starts, mostly. I mean, at the end of the day, when you look at it, if someone says, oh, AC deserved it, not Ferrandis, I would disagree to an extent because Ferrandis was out front. And Cincerelli would know that to an extent. And like I said, it's not like he had a 20-point lead where he could go, yeah. I'll just circulate. He had to race.
But he was getting it done. You know,
Everyone was getting it done. Then Cincerella had that little mistake. Because even with Sexton, you could see he was just doing what he had to do, going through the motions.
And well, that's a pressure cooker, man. Like, being in those situations is rough.
Well, think about it for him. Young kid, you've been in the shadows. Someone gets hurt. You win your first race and take the points lead. Now you're supposed to win the next weekend. So it was a pretty quick escalation.
Here's a bigger pressure cooker. Given the new rules now in that 250 class, Chase has one more year, and he's got to go to 450, period.
I don't like that rule.
That's a shitty rule.
Yeah.
Because he is not going to be ready for the 450 Supercross class. I'm sorry. Even if he has a contract
even if
to
he
go
is,
up, that's a young kid.
You're going to force a 20-year-old?
Nah, it's a, I don't like the rule. You know, Mitch even said, he with Davalos, he said, we gave him the option at Vegas. Look, if you want to have us bench you, we'll bench you. Because right now, there's not a lot of rides open for next year. You haven't had a season that is going to get you a 450 ride. You're going to struggle to find something. So I'll bench you. I'll take the heat for it and say you're not racing. And that way you've got some options for next year. If you can't put a 450 deal together, we'll support you for Supercross only. And to Martin's credit, he said, no, I want to go race. I'm going to, you know.
Finish it
I'm
out.
I'm going to do it. Yeah. And so.
He's had a lot of shit over the years, let's be honest. So I think for he's probably just trying to do what he thinks is best for him right now and just.
Yeah, but Mitch and I talked about this today. Name maybe a bunch of riders, as many as you can, who moved up either willingly or were forced out of the 250 class and had to go it as a privateer who eventually went on to have success in that class.
Oh, as a privateer?
Nick Way is the only guy I can come up with. He pointed out at Pro Circuit, moved up, was a privateer Yamaha guy, and he eventually turned that into a factory Suzuki ride and, you know, had some success in the 450 class down the road. I can't think of any other rider that's done.
Yeah.
When you get pushed out like that, you're basically done. You're going to arena cross. You're going to Europe.
Well, it's also whatever. I think it's also easy for the people you know watching to go, oh well, he shouldn't be there. Someone else deserves it. But until they realize what everyone sacrificed, I also don't think it's fair to push people out of the way purely because of, you know, this is professional sports. To me, there shouldn't be really a point out system or an age or a you know, if you're good enough to be there, the best make it. You know, take the best of the best. Whether you're 16 or 60, I don't care. Like.
Yeah, amen.
And to that point in the 80s, a buddy of mine raced two classes. He raced both classes in Supercross, the 125 and 250. And why can't you do that if they need to make a living?
Yeah, listen, if you want my opinion, put a salary cap on the 250 class. So you can't pay him more than $150,000, all right? And then
if it's a true feeder class,
Well, right, then at least the motivation to move up is
to make
you want
to
get paid.
Yeah,
I mean, and I think the guys who are the best of the best are going to move up.
They move up anyway.
The minute you have an opportunity to move up, you're going.
Yeah.
So anyway, we go round and around on that. I definitely am not a guy that's going to sit there and crap on a guy like Martin Davalos, or some people were kind of scoffing at Shane McElrath for kind of sitting the end of the season out because he was in the same situation. He finishes out the season and gets enough points. He's up to the 450 class. And frankly, he hasn't had a good enough season to earn a 450 ride. There's not a lot of seats left.
Well, there's
our guest today, Dean Wilson, was a privateer at the start of the season. I mean, Husky support, but he didn't have a ride. Great riders like that are struggling to get rides. So now you're going to push out all these great 250 riders because they had three consistent seasons.
And then the other problem I have with that is you push great proven riders out of the class, and then they bring in kids that have never proven themselves, who are on massive salaries based on the fact that they had to go, so we're just hoping this is the next best thing.
Yeah.
You know, to me, you give a 15-year-old a massive contract, I also think there's some long-term repercussions from that, too.
Plus, you mean a 15-year-old isn't responsible with money and finances and life? No,
most likely not.
Plus, you don't point out in the Nationals, right? I mean,
no.
You can ride that class as long as you want.
Yeah. Anyway, we could go on and on. It was an interesting Supercross season. Really excited for the Nationals to kick off. Our next thing I want to talk about is the Broc Tickle penalty. There was finally a verdict rendered after an eternity of WADA just hanging out with their heads up their asses. And actually, we have Broc Tickle here tonight. He's hanging out with Dean Wilson, came to support his buddy. Broc, come on up. Give it up for Broc Tickle, everybody.
So just so you know, this was not even planned. BT decided to come out, hang out, check out his buddies, and I said, hey, you know what? We were going to talk about this painful experience, and figured who better to tell it than the man himself.
The man himself. Welcome to the show, Broc.
Yeah, thanks for having me last minute.
Yeah, exactly. Well, so, thanks for coming on, and
yeah,
I know you got a question.
Tell us, I mean, this thing took forever. You know, we can argue whether or not their testing process and all this crap is right or wrong, but the fact that they take so long to sit down with you and discuss it and say, okay, here's the penalty. Totally unacceptable. I mean, what's your thoughts?
I mean, the whole process, I think, is, yeah, it's not right, 100%. Obviously, there should be drug testing, I think. But it was frustrating because I didn't know what to do the last, basically, year. I didn't know what if I should plan to go this direction or go that direction. So I kind of been in limbo. And then I was kind of nervous if I did get cleared. Well, I need to be ready. So I was training like I was going to race.
Which is hard. It's train and not have any kind of goal out in front of you.
Exactly. So now that I have closure with knowing when I need to be ready, it is good. Obviously, the time frame isn't what I was looking for. But I'm moving forward now, at least with a plan. The goal right now is to, like, I'm getting my personal trainer certification. I'm going to do the USMCA certification.
Oh, good.
Do some coaching, do some schools with RV, maybe some Weimer, do a couple of my own, and then in the next couple of months, maybe come up with a plan to put together my own deal to go racing in February.
And so tell us what the verdict was. It was a year and a half.
Well, no, it's 2 years from the date.
2 years from the date.
Of the race. So when I got tested. And normally it's supposed to be 2 years from the date that you got notified. So they did give me a little bit of backdating there, but I feel like for the compound and the benefits of what the compound would actually do and the situation, they believe there was no proof that I wasn't innocent or didn't do it on purpose. So for me, from their side, they believe that I took something on purpose. So, and that's why I ended up being 2 years still. And they backdated it, I believe, to cover them on only 2 months, but they backdated it to basically prove, you know what I mean, that they kind of messed up.
It sure would have been nice. If you look at penalties in other sports, man, it sure doesn't seem like 2 years is it seems like a long time.
Well, the thing that sucks to me is the fans actually forgot. They're like, oh yeah, you know, I was waiting to hear about that.
Well, if a football guy or, you know, a stick and ball guy gets busted for something, even something, you know, some type of steroid or something, it's like 6 months. It's much shorter. And so they couldn't even,
full,
like,
games.
The thing that sucked to me is they couldn't even go, okay, we'll take it to the end of 2019. That way you could start the Supercross season.
Yep.
It screwed you for the Supercross series.
Well, I mean, there's another scenario too I look at. Say I knew it was 2 years.
2 years
six
ago?
Six and a half months ago or 8 months ago, I could have appealed the process because I feel like it's too long, and then it would be reasonable. But right now, if I appeal, I will never know. It probably will be February before I know if I'm going to win the appeal. So,
are you guys going down that road at all?
No,
or no?
I'm ending it here, move on, and make a plan.
So, I mean, that's really a tough sell to a team. Hey, starting in February, I can race.
Yep.
Are you just going to try to put together your own program?
I mean, I know how it works. I mean, the 450 class, you guys will agree, is overloaded. Yeah. There's guys that aren't signed yet. You have Dean, you have Seeley, you have Savacci, and a handful of other guys that have had good years. And I know with me not racing the last 2 years now, come next season, that I'm on the bottom of the totem pole. Mm-hmm. Even though...
Because you
I
haven't
feel
been
like
racing.
In certain scenarios, I could be a better pick for the spot.
Yeah.
So.
And there's nowhere you can go race, right? Like, I was thinking, what about Australia? What about any of that? It screws you for all that?
That's what makes it difficult. There's a very gray area there. If I went to Canada last summer and this summer, it would restart my start date.
Oh.
So that's the problem with the whole scenario. And I guess it applies to any type of sport that is under WADA. Even if it's over the hump. If I race expert and make $150 or whatever to win, I think it could. It's gray enough to, I believe that it would reset.
If they wanted to, they could reset.
Yes.
Well, we've shared our opinions about WADA on here, and it's not good. I would rather see USADA. There's got to be... I don't feel like there's nearly as many issues with them, and they handle all the nationals. WADA's been a shit show, along with the FIM, ever since they came on board. And I would love to see the powers that be. I don't know if it'll happen. I'd love to see them tell FIM and WADA to go take a leap. But
in my opinion, big picture.
Anybody else feel that same way?
Yeah. I think big picture-wise, I look at it, and I went through it. This had a lot to do with James like getting out. And not coming back. I definitely believe it 100%.
Well, yeah, and he tried to come back and say, it's tough, man. Like,
no, it's
to
not
take
easy.
A year, 2 years off.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard. You can't lose that much time.
No. Well, and on that point, what was the last year like for you?
I mean, coming into my suspension, I think I had two top fives, and my last race was a fourth. So, like, I was getting on the cusp of breaking through with the change that I had going into the 2018 season, which was probably it was the toughest off season I've had overall. I think it was difficult because I was used to RCH for the last 4 years prior to that. So like there was a lot of different variables in the equation. But
yeah, you were just starting to find your groove.
Exactly.
Well, we'd love to get you on the show, on your own show, and sit down with you for a long time. But we appreciate you coming on and sharing this what's going on here.
Yep.
And at least we have some closure. We know you'll be back racing next year.
February 2020. Yeah. Broc Tickle's coming back, everybody. Thanks, you. Guys. Thanks for coming on, man.
Thank you.
Good luck. Well, that's cool that we have Broc coming on. Thanks, buddy.
Sorry about our... It's like a death trap back here. Just watch it.
Nothing fell over. All right, we're good. All right. Well, that wraps up our Method Race Wheels front end chatter. And stoked that Broc was here to actually come on and talk about that in person.
Nothing better than hearing it from the horse's mouth.
That's it. Hey, I want to mention a couple things. We've got some new merchandise available. Who here is stoked on the Patrick Potato T-shirt? Listen, you got to kind of be a Whiskey Throttle fan to know what this is. So go back and listen to the old episodes if you don't. But these are available at whiskeythrottlemerch.com from Temecula T-shirt Printers. If you guys are looking for something locally for your business or something to produce T-shirts, hats, they make everything. These guys are awesome. They also run the Academy MX series. If you guys are looking for fun racing, I think there's a race going on actually this weekend. AcademyMXSeries.com, at Academy MX Series. Check those guys out. They're really cool, and it's a super fun series of racing. Low pressure, long motos. It's a super good time. So really want to thank those guys. And we're going to do a contest in honor of the launching of our Patrick Potato shirt. We want you to send us a picture on Instagram of the Patrick Potato in your group of riding buddies. So if you've got some guy who's just a real asshole, he's got his goggles strapped down, he's wearing mismatched gear, whatever it is, send us a picture. The biggest Patrick Potato story we get, he's going to win a swag bag, including one of these T-shirts. So send those to at Whiskey Throttle Show on Twitter, or Instagram, rather. You'll never know our Twitter handle. It's not memorizable. But send that to us on Instagram. We're going to give away a pack there for somebody. I want to bring up our featured guest now, Dean Wilson. Brought to you by PowerDot. Listen, go check out PowerDot at PowerDot.com. Type in Whiskey Throttle on checkout. You get 20% off. Awesome, awesome products. Dean Wilson, come on up, buddy. Let's give it up for Dean Wilson. What's up, buddy? Thanks for coming on, dude.
Hey, no crashing back here.
Yeah, watch out for all the wires and boxes and...
You can take all your swag over there.
All right, we're going to give this away later. Dino, welcome to the show, man.
Thanks for having me. Thanks, everybody, for coming out, too. Appreciate it. Thank you. They must be coming for you guys. No, I don't think they're coming for me.
Oh, no, they're coming for you.
They're coming for GL.
I seriously got no more than 5 emails. Hey, is Andy going to be there? They want your box here, man.
Yeah, Andy was going to come, but he's on rest mode right now, so...
Yeah, well, we wish him the best. Bummed he couldn't be here, but we totally get it. First things first, are you healthy? How you feeling?
I'm getting healthier, yeah. Just it's my shoulder that's kind of the problem. I hurt my shoulder and my kidneys at Colorado Supercross. And,
Dude, that crash was brutal.
Yeah, that one hurt. So, and it was really cold that night, too.
We heard it. Like, literally.
Yeah.
You hear, you go, ugh!
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, I remember that feeling.
Oh, it's not good.
Don't miss it.
So, yeah, I mean, just... I dislocated my shoulder at the back posterior, so that actually really, really hurt. I've dislocated it at the front, it's not that bad, but the back was like, I thought my whole arm was broken at first, but anyways, 4 hours later, they got it in.
Oh, and, it took them that long to reduce
that.
Yeah,
and it hurt so bad, and then my kidneys hurt too, but...
Did the bike hit you in the back, or how'd you hurt your kidneys?
I think I got the handlebar to the... So, yeah, it was unfortunate.
Yikes, man. So. Well, you got sixth in this series, which is your best overall finish in the 450 Supercross class, right? And a podium.
Yep.
Are you happy with your season? I mean, aside from the mishap in Denver?
Yeah, not too bad. Not too bad. Like, if I could go back, it would be Anaheim 1, where it was in my hands. I just felt like the last 5 minutes, I went over the finish line and I was looking up at the clock to see how long I had, and then it all started to sink in, like, oh, this is like I could win this, and winning it as a privateer would have just been insane. So started to think too much, tightened up, and then I got water in my tear offs, and then it just kind of went and then I was still in third to last lap and Tomac got me. So other than that though, I think it was a good season. I was healthy, just an unfortunate accident that got me injured, but you know, I got a podium, and I think every weekend I was getting better. My qualifying times were always like battling for the top spot, and was getting better. So it's a tough class. So I'm pretty happy with how it went.
I mean, overall, if you look at, like I said, the stats, it's the best you've ever done. So you can't be too bummed. Obviously, you always wish you didn't get hurt, but to start off the season with nothing, just privateer status, bump up to a factory ride, get a podium.
No,
you can't be too sad about that.
No, it was good. It was good. It was a lot of work during December, organizing everything, just mentally. Like, I had so much on my mind, and it was good for me as a person to grow. And, you know, I'll give Husqvarna, Bobby Hewitt, and everybody were still a great help to me. They gave me factory engines. So it's not like I was full privateer. I had a lot of good help, but I still did a lot of the logistics in my head.
You got to figure out your sponsors and how you lay out the rig and this and where you park and who's
that's
there.
That's stuff you normally don't have to figure out.
Right. And I wasn't like, I don't have an agent, and I was like doing it all on my own, and I kind of wanted it done a certain way. And so it was a lot, but it was good for me, and I learned a lot. And yeah, it turned out okay. So
you also had a huge following from the fans, because we know from a birdie inside that you were selling a lot of merch as well. There were a lot of Dino fans out there.
Yeah, no, it was awesome. It was much appreciated. I think, you know, the fans kind of like a story, and I think mine was kind of unique, and it was kind of cool. It was just me, my dad, Paul. You know, it was like, I don't know if anyone's watched Beer Fest, but they, like, gather the old team back together, you know? So it was pretty cool. And
Did you guys have a big boot you drank beer out of?
Yeah, that was our training. So
yeah, there you go. It's a shoey.
Yeah. So, no, it was good. It was a lot of fun, and I was in a good headspace too. But I also worked really, really hard for the season, and, it worked out okay. So.
Well, cool, man. Well, I want to go back to the very beginning here for you. That's just the way we start these out. Tell us about growing up a wee lad in Glasgow.
Well, growing up in Scotland, it always rained. So when my dad took me to the track, it was always muddy, it felt like. And I was on a 50, an LEM 50, and started riding when I was 4. And then, you know, I got a KX60 with the purple seat, if you remember those.
Yep.
And raced that. And then in 1999 is when we moved to Canada.
So how old were you then?
I was 8.5 or 9 years old.
Okay.
So spent a good time, like raced in Scotland and stuff like that. And
what was it like over there? What was racing in Scotland like?
It's not massive, but still quite a few good riders. Sean Simpson.
He was around back then?
Yeah.
Okay. You guys are similar age, I guess.
He's, I think, 3 years older than me. But
there's a ping. There's a picture.
Billy McKenzie.
Yeah. Yes. And see, that was me on the 60, but I did have one with the purple seat. That's not, I had another 60, but I was actually Ricky Carmichael inspired me. I had the Fox gear, the Bell helmet, the spy goggles. Like, I had the full thing. So.
Now, did Andy cut those numbers out, or what happened on that?
No, that was definitely an Andy job.
It looks like a hungry nine. And it looks like it's going to eat something.
You know what the best part is? Like, my eyes are barely even, like, out the goggle. Like, I don't even know how I could see.
The goggles are held by your
and
eyes.
And honest to God, I remember those goggles to this day, that the lenses were so scratched, I didn't know how I could see out them either, but it's actually quite a funny story, because I rode that bike always on this little track, and the gas cap fell off this one time. I didn't know what had happened, and my legs and everything else was on fire.
Yeah.
And I was just a wee lad running about like I was like, Dad, something. And he's pouring water over me, and it's quite funny. So,
well, I remember the strap on the back of the seat.
Yeah.
Back on those old cowies, so you could pick it up.
Yeah.
That's great.
No, it was the old days for sure.
So you did quite a bit of racing then, even young age, before you left. So then why'd you guys move to Canada?
I think for my dad's work, he was a finishing carpenter, built kitchens, cabinets, did all that. And the business was really boom, like he was really busy. And it was stressful. And my dad had previously worked in Canada with his brother before I was born. Mm. So we already had, him and my mom already had their passports. So they wanted a bit of a change, because the business was just getting too stressful. So we moved everything to Canada.
Calgary, right?
Yep, Calgary. Yeah. And so we moved there and rode at Blackfoot, this track in Calgary, which was really, really good. But the thing is when in the winters it was so cold. So we'd come down to California for a couple weeks at a time, and I started getting better. Then the next year it was like a couple months, and then the next year it was like 6 months. And then after that, I got picked up by Team Green, and we ended up moving here. So
when you came down, would your dad come with you?
Yeah, it was.
And he'd just take time off work?
Yep, he would take time off work, and my mom, dad, sister would stay in the fifth wheel trailer. The state park up by Star West. If you remember, you know, the Paris State Park,
okay, would
stay
yeah,
up
Paris,
there.
Yeah,
yeah, would stay up there. So, like, back in, this is early 2000s, so, like, the tracks were just booming. Like, we'd go to Star West in the morning and then Paris night, you know, at night. So, I'd go ride Star West in the morning, go do schoolwork in the middle of the day, dad would do bike work, and then we'd go to Paris. Like, it was, I just remember those days. It was so packed, and you'd go to Elsinore, and McGrath would be there, and it was, the line to get in was just massive.
That's what it was like. That's around the same time when I moved to the States.
Yeah.
Like, I remember going to Elsinore in, like, 01 when we were teammates. You know, like, geez, there were lines out the back. There would be, like, 500 riders on a day.
It was insane. And dudes would just circle the big jump in the middle. There's those guys that would just circle that big jump in the middle.
And there would be all their, like, girlfriends and buddies taking pictures. And get that one for the gram.
I don't even know what it was back then.
No, that was at MySpace.
I don't even know if it was they had to go develop the pictures.
Yeah. They were doing it for the dark room.
A lot of guys in white beaters doing wheelies through the parking lot.
Yeah.
Too.
Oh, yeah.
That happened all the time.
That was Bro Central.
Oh, yeah.
There it is.
Well, when I moved here, I remember they're like, oh, this is the 909. I'm like, oh, okay. And then started figuring that out pretty quick.
Right.
What that meant.
Yeah, it was pretty cool.
Flat bill and black socks.
Oh, man.
Wheelies in the pits all day.
Cottonmouth Kings blaring at some big brodozer. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was it. It was definitely the peak of the. The IE.
So nothing's changed. the brodozers are just bigger.
Yeah. Yeah. So you guys stayed in Canada till when? At what point did you guys go, all right, let's move down? And was it because of racing?
Yeah, it was because of racing. So we lived in Canada. We raced all the races there and did the amateur nationals and stuff. And it was a lot of fun. Met some great friends and... So, yeah, we just got better and better. We still came down to do the Lorette Lens, the World Minis, and stuff like that. And
were you doing that from Canada, too?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So, it was a lot of driving and travel. So, anyways, Dave Gellin was the Team Green guy back then.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember I raced Lorettes, and the top 12 qualified for the U.S. Open, and that was 2005. And Team Green picked me up after the U.S. Open, which was Dave Gellin, and got me the whole ride. And so, we all just committed to come here and 2005.
That's big, man. I would actually love to ask your dad, what was it like? I mean, did you guys sit down and talk about that decision to go? Or
yeah, I mean,
do you remember how that went?
It was just that sacrifice. Like, who knows if it was going to work or not? You know, like, it's crazy. So it was kind of scary in a way, you know. But it was like for me, it was like, you know, like, we've made this huge move. Like, I need to make it happen. And Team Green had such a good contingency program that on the weekends, you could race like 4 or 5 classes as an amateur and get the contingency and make like $1,200 to $1,500, which was really good. And that would help me, you know,
go to the next race,
whatever, you know. So that was a great help. That was really awesome. So it was, I think that was a lot of motivation for me, though, to make it was like.
Did that add pressure to you? I mean, as a kid, that's a lot of.
I don't think I fully understood it, but I kind of. You know, did get the message that this was
serious. It's like, hey, but your life doesn't depend on it, but we really need that. So go and freaking win this race.
So.
No pressure, dude, but
anything but winning is a failure.
Yeah, I remember actually, it's quite funny. In 2005, when we lived in Canada, we had a Lorette Lynn regional qualifier
in Canada.
No, Glen Helen.
Oh,
but we drove from Canada to this regional, and you had to make the top five. And everybody came to it. Tomac, Wharton, like there were so many. Baggett, there were so many fast guys, and I didn't even know. Like I was so like we drove this far. If I wasn't making this, like the drive back would have been the worst drive ever. So it's actually quite funny. I came and I absolutely killed it. Like totally surprised myself. I won like my classes and Eli Tomac tore me down. My 85.
No way.
And there's like 40 people surrounding this pop up tent. And, you know, we came from Canada, so everyone was calling me, like, the Canadian kid got tore down. And, you know, obviously we knew it was good. It was the 8.5, 12 to 13 stock class. And Tom Morgan was the one tearing it down. And it was like, obviously, like, the bike was brand new out the box. But, yeah, it was pretty nerve-wracking. Like, but, yeah, made like 150.
Yeah, I was going to say, they got whatever they put up, you get to keep, right?
Right, right. Yeah. So, yeah, it was
so
pretty
cool.
So it
was a really good weekend.
It was. But it's actually quite funny because my dad's someone that doesn't let... he doesn't let things go very well, so he's still like...
Still hates
hey,
John Tomac.
Still better at John
Tomac. sounds like my dad at times.
Yeah.
Have you ever said that to him? You ever said it to Tomac?
Oh, no. So, it's just funny we laugh about it.
You haven't talked to Eli about that at all? Like,
no, he doesn't talk a whole lot. And no, we've had a few run-ins, but we're cool now. But, yeah. We just kind of do our own thing.
You, Scott, that's a Scott thing, huh? You kind of hold grudges.
Yeah,
you're kind of grumpy.
I'm better than my dad. My dad's pretty.
You got a little Canadian.
And you know what? He's not changing. So the thing is, like, he's his age now. He's not changing now. So it is what it is. So yeah,
it's like my old man. It's just
your two dads together, Dad. Like a couple of.
At least Andy looks like he's happy to see you. Gerald just looks like he's still like, yeah, whatever, bro.
Yeah, Andy's always smiling. Your dad. I don't know if I've ever seen him smile.
If he's smiling, you know he's shit-faced.
Does he have teeth? Oh, yeah, there he is. Yeah.
No. If he's smiling, he's like quite a few deep. Just chilling.
Oh, man.
We call it autopilot. He's on autopilot.
Yeah.
Hey, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, does it?
Yeah. I'm not on autopilot yet.
Okay, all right.
Maybe off the TLD
I was
break.
Just talking about the shit-faced part.
Yeah. I don't know who's mixing his drinks tonight, but let's keep them, you know. Water them down, just a touch.
We've had what do you call it? We've had too many coffee throttle shows. It's time to get back to whiskey throttle. So we've got to keep it going.
That's true.
We're trying to get the ratings up here. Yeah.
There is people that like it when he gets sloppy. At the end of Twitch's show, there was like...
Move on.
I might have to watch that one.
That was a different time.
Just fast forward to the last
Quit living in the past.
I have some outtakes as well if you want to see the outtakes.
We had to edit about 10 minutes.
I actually heard a good Pulp MX show from GL one time as well.
Oh, yeah.
I was there for that one. I saw
I heard the ride home was even more interesting.
Yeah, Husqvarna.
Yeah, that's great.
All right. Well, what about Canada? So how long did you live there?
I lived there for about 5 to 6 years.
And you raced
from 1999 to 2005.
Was the racing good up there? Like
amateur
scene? Oh, it
was awesome. Yeah, it was good. It was had a lot of fun there. The track at Blackfoot was always so cool because it was like always the same people would go there. So everyone would work during the day. We would go to school and then the track would open at like 3 or 4 in the afternoon. Then it'd be like a good night session, and I'll always have good memories from there because it was just good people, and I just really enjoyed it. So raced there. I always got protested a lot there in Canada, though. Like, I don't know if they liked it when I went. I'd come to California, I'd come back, and I'd be like really fast. And if you like jumped on the yellow flag or did anything, it was like there was a scope on me, and I always got protested. So Andy didn't like that very much. I remember I was racing this one time at what is called the Western Canadian Amateur Nationals. And I was hitting this low line that was there, and in the middle of the race, they put tires on it, and my dad lost the plot. And yeah, it was not good. So
he hates Canadians?
No,
he hates John
no,
Tomac?
Americans. No, it was just, yeah, I always got protested. So other than that, though, that was when I was young. Always had a great time.
Was Wild Rose Raceway open then?
That's Blackfoot.
Oh, that's Blackfoot.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and it's so cool because it's just in the city. Like the main jump backdrop is the city. It's beautiful. It's so cool.
I went up and did after I had quit racing. I did a national up there.
Yeah.
And it's nuts. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, as you're jumping around this track, you look and the whole city of Calgary is right behind you.
Like it's in the city, which is unbelievable. So
pretty neat.
It's really
and good
cool.
dirt. Like it's a rad
that's
spot.
That's fun. Mm-hmm. Who it's was awesome. Your like who did you battle with back then in Canada?
Back then, at the Amateur Nationals, it was Cole Thompson.
Oh, yeah.
So he was good.
Yeah, tough.
And there was like a few good riders that don't really race anymore. But yeah, Cole Thompson was kind of like the main one. He was always younger than me, though. Mm. But yeah, the main guy was Cole, I believe.
Anybody else that grew up with you kind of that was from that era that was fast, whether they stayed in Canada or not or no?
Not that I
recall. Not so much.
Call.
Yeah. I don't think so. It's tough, man. If you hadn't moved to the States, like, I doubt you'd have made it, right? Like,
yeah.
No, I grew up in Montana.
Right.
And it's not a whole lot. It's not far from
Montana's
Calgary.
Not far from up there. It's just...
And you can't ride for, like, 6 months?
Yeah, it's the exact same. Yeah. Well, that's why we always
came
down.
That's the thing that I always found crazy was part of the reason growing up on dirt bikes in South Africa was we could ride 300 at least 50 days of the year.
Yeah.
I look at places like where you said you guys grew up, and I'm like, excuse my French, but who the fuck would buy a dirt bike in that part of the world? Like, yeah. I don't get it. Like, get a snowmobile.
Yeah. A lot of people do, so.
Yeah.
Good for you guys. Glad to have you guys around.
So what year did you move to the U.S.?
The end of 2005. That U.S. Open that I raced.
Yeah.
Yeah, we.
That was the deciding factor.
Yeah. I got the contract that weekend from Team Green.
Yeah.
And when you guys got that contract, that's when you guys sat down.
We got a house, yeah.
Where'd you move? Just you bought a house
in San Jacinto.
Okay.
Woo!
San Jacinto, we got a house right here.
Yeah, we got a couple.
By Cardenas. By Cardenas.
Yeah.
A good carne asada.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, good.
So, was there any reason for that? Or
it was cheap.
Okay.
Yeah, it was
okay.
Really cheap. We're on a budget.
The casino was there, too. Don't forget. You go to Saboba. Hang out.
So was your dad?
It was close to where that Destinations was supposed
yes,
to be. It was
yes,
close
yes,
to
yes,
that.
Yes,
I was
yes.
really close to that. Mm. So, yeah.
Did your dad have work lined up down here or no? When you guys moved?
Yeah. No. He was a lot of work.
I'm not trying to get my dad arrested right now.
He put him to work.
I put him to work.
Child labor.
Yeah.
Well, how did you handle passports and stuff? Or like, it's tough to get a visa down
yeah,
here.
Yeah, well, I got my sports visa. Okay. And then when you have that for so long, I got my green card. So I have my green card now.
Okay.
So.
Or how does you know this? How does that process work?
It's a long freaking process.
Yeah, you got to get obviously lawyers and all that to get all that done.
It's expensive too.
We're good now.
Yeah.
So
do you remember when I raced Toronto Supercross?
Yeah, you had
my
issues.
My rookie year, and I was.
That was one of my questions, actually.
I was already in the process of it, but I didn't have it yet. You know, I was like supposed to come before the season. Of course, it didn't happen, and then. So when I raced in Toronto and I was third in points as a rookie, like doing really well, came to come back cross and then like, dude, they wouldn't like let us cross.
Yeah.
And I missed. Me and Baggett were like big nemesis then. And I was stuck in Canada and he got his first win.
Yeah.
Career
win.
So pissed.
Oh, I was on the couch. I was like in tears. So.
Yeah, that's a rough one.
That's happened like Duvalos. Didn't that happen to Duvalos as well?
Duvalos didn't even end up going there because
he was afraid.
His passport.
Well, think about backing it up even further, Albertine wasn't allowed in certain countries back then because of apartheid. He couldn't go to Sweden.
Did
Swedish
he miss races?
Yeah.
Because of a what?
Because of apartheid. You know, the whole racial thing in South Africa.
All right.
Certain countries wouldn't let him in because he was South African.
Hmm.
So he had his own set of issues.
Yeah,
but
that's crazy, man.
Well, I've always been paranoid about that stuff, but I got my U.S. passport. So
yeah, there you go.
Well, I'm surprised that Feld doesn't think of that. I mean, maybe that's part of the reason we don't go to Canada anymore because there are a lot of international racers.
There's been a few issues, yeah.
God, yep. I think I never thought about the GPs, but every single round is in a different country.
Well, when I had my European visa, we'd go to Brazil or Indonesia or you know any of these Eastern European countries where you have to get visas. So you'd have to go to the South African consulate in Paris. So we'd have to drive hours to go and make an appointment to wait. And it was a pain in the ass, but also nerve-wracking because they're like, yeah, we're flying on this flight. Okay, we can't book our ticket until we get our visa. So it was always a...
Yeah, those guys make you nervous too at the border.
Well, they're also dicks.
Yeah.
Let's be honest. They're real dicks. They got a little authority and they just like treat you like a criminal.
It's like stadium security. You just give them a little bit of power and they lose their shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like a mall cop.
Yeah.
Paul Blart.
Bunch of Paul Blarts.
Hey, we need to be careful on who we're letting into this country, don't you know?
Don't you know? Yeah, I know. Easy there, Minnesota Donnie. Don't you know? Okay, so once you moved here, what year was that again?
End of 05.
So 05, I think I used to see you out at like State Street.
Mm-hmm.
I was training with the Tedder kids. I would like go out and train with them. And I'd see you out there just pounding motos all the time.
When it was raining, that was always the spot.
Yeah.
On the golf course.
You've always been a hard worker, man. That's something I've always appreciated about you is like you were not afraid to put the work in.
No.
You rode a lot.
Yeah, I've always been that. Even when I rode for Mitch and still today, it's what I think makes me excel is I'll just love a lot of bike time. I like to put in my motos and just keep riding all day. Because it just gives me that comfortability and that confidence and that feel of the bike. I know everything it's going to do. And I don't know, some people like to cut the riding short and do more gym work, but I always just felt like I was someone that enjoyed to ride a lot because it just made me comfy at the races. So.
Yeah. We hear that a lot. Like Marty Smith was talking about that. Like a lot of the guys we have on say that same thing.
I still believe in it. I mean, yeah. I mean, Ricky rode a lot in the beginning. Yeah, he was a little bit pudgy, but he still kicked everyone's ass. He got in better shape, but he still kicked everyone's ass. Yeah. So at the end of the day, I think he just upped his overall training. He didn't cut his riding time. But yeah. I've always believed in ride as much as you possibly can.
Yeah.
If you're hating the bike, yes, maybe take a little time off or go hit the hills mm-hmm. or do something different. But, I mean, I don't...
Well, when you're riding with Mitch and you got Bones, you know, taking you out, that was something I learned a lot.
Hey, how many times did you have to hear his bullshit story about the sun setting, the moisture's rising, the lap times are dropping.
There's
a new lap record.
Bones is actually here.
Track's coming around.
Yeah, it's coming around. It's blue groove. You got no knobbies on your tire. And he's like, I think there's a lap record in the making here.
That's it.
I know you got it in you, Dino.
And if you got, if we got that, like, bet the good fork setting, it was the super fork. We got the super fork. So those were the good days. I enjoyed that. We always put in a lot of laps, road till dark. Mm-hmm. And I like that because then when you go home, you're satisfied. You feel good with the bag. You got a good scent. I really like
that. I think it also helped just here, like just to feel like, you know what? I rode more than anyone
else. Who
else
put in that amount of time riding today, you know? Yeah. So I enjoyed that.
Did Bones ever mess with you?
No, but I just hate when he'd always take us to Comp Edge on Tuesdays because it was windy, it was the drive, and it was just like, I that was one thing I didn't enjoy.
I had it one time. I couldn't tell the difference in this shock, and I was there was something I didn't like, and so I pulled in. I'm like, man, I don't know, man. It's still just this one thing. Here, let me change something. He goes down and just, you know, fiddles with the clicker. Try that. I think you're going to like this. I think this is it. So I go out and do a couple more laps. I'm like, yeah, I think that's a little better. What do we do? Nothing. He turned it in two clicks and then turned it back out. I'm like, you son of a bitch. He goes, yeah, we're done. You're tired.
That's something I would say.
But mind you, that was at like 7 p.m.
We also have a titanium spring story that goes a little bit like that too. So, yeah. All right, I didn't like the tie spring. And then he threw it on there and I came in. I'm like, I like it.
We could talk Bones stories all night. So how did that go your first few years down here? Were you hitting all the amateur nationals, mm-hmm. going hard?
Yeah, I hit it was Team Green. 85. I was one last year on my 85, and I was like kind of a fourth to fifth place guy. The next year was my first year on a big bike, and I was like a same fourth to fifth place guy. And then I was like, that was the schoolboy class, and then next year was the B class, and I got on Bobby Hewitt's Extreme Team Green, and it was a lot more support underneath the semi and stuff like that. And I won quite a bit, but I really stepped up, and the support and everything was really good. So the next year of that was 2009, and that was like my year, like, to make it happen.
You won a ton of titles that year, right?
Yeah, I barely lost all year. It was like I just knew that this was the year to make it happen before I went pro. And I always just wanted to ride for Mitch. That was all I wanted to do. And I remember I wanted to ride for him so bad, and I knew I had to go talk to him. But like, it's just putting myself in that position was not something I liked. Like, I'm 17, I'm like, my hands are all sweaty, and I just remember he's got his big gulp cup from the gas station. And I remember I walked in there and I won World Minis, all my classes. I think I didn't even lose. I won 12 for 12, and like, he gave me an ignition for that weekend. So I started off, thanks for the ignition, I really appreciate it. He's like, you're welcome. And I was like, that was it. And I'm like, and I'm starting to sweat. And I'm like, I just really want to like let you know, I really want to ride for your team, blah, blah. And he's like, just nods his head and then takes a gulp. And I'm just like, I'm sweating so bad. And you can tell now that I'm older, he just enjoyed like watching me sweat it. And I was just like, okay, well, I'm going to go.
So you were like, big gulps, huh?
Yeah.
Well, see you later. Yeah.
So it was nerve-wracking, but it's just, I don't know, I felt like that was important and he liked to see that. I put myself in that position that I didn't want to do it, but I really wanted to be on his team. And he left it so long at the end of my amateur year to let me know I was on the team. I had a few options, but I was waiting those out till Mitch gave me the okay. Yeah. So yeah, that's how
I remember the first time I ever actually physically saw you ride was at Parla in 2009, and you had just come off kind of winning and everything. And I remember watching, and I was like, man, that kid's good. And they're like, that's that Dean Wilson. And I always just loved watching you ride and your style and your technique. And it was like, I remember thinking, I'm like, I'm curious because I want to watch this kid because he looks like he's got, you know, all the core ingredients. And I always feel like with certain kids, I have this, I don't know, just I just want to watch and follow because you're curious. You're like, he's got everything. Is it going to work out?
Right,
and,
right.
And, you know, yeah. So you see yeah. that. And, you know, like AC was mm-hmm. always supposed to be the next big right. thing. So you always have a feeling like you watch it. But I remember watching out at Paul and I was like, wow, this kid's got something special. You had a really cool, unique technique as well.
Yeah, yeah, I was always like, fun. I always loved Filippotto's style. And, but I got a lot taller than Filippotto, but I always like, hung off the back. I, like when I was smaller, I was hung off the back and I looked a lot like Filippotto, but then I got taller. So I had to like adjust a bit. And then I got like more into like Stefan Everts. I loved how he always stood up. And so I tried to mimic that. So I was like, but I just rode so much back then. I'd go riding at Glen Helen and then I'd go to the hills and do figure eights. And there's so many drills I would do. And to this day, I still do that. But when I look back, I just rode so much and I wanted it that bad. And I mean, obviously I do now too, but it really, I think that's what helped me.
Yeah,
for sure.
So. Well, like I said, when I would see you out there riding, we'd be a whole day working with those couple of kids I was working with. And I'd look over and you're still just grinding. I'm like, this kid, man, what is this guy? Serious. So 08 and 09, you did really well at the amateur stuff, won a bunch of titles. 2010 was your pro debut, and did you start at Supercross that year?
Started Supercross, yep. Started.
Take us through that season.
Supercross. I remember to this day the first day on the bike, and it was like, oh, like I finally got on a Mitch Payton Cowie 250. Yeah. Oh, and the thing was so sick, like because they were just so above everyone else. Like the bike,
especially at that time, too.
The bike was amazing, and I did pretty good. Like I was pretty. Real close. Like Weimer was the man at the time, right? He was winning the championship.
You rode West that year?
I was supposed to be West, but it's actually a funny story. So 2010 rookie year, having a great off season. I'm riding really well and it rained really hard. And I'm like, how Mitch always gives us a 450 to ride. So I'm like, I'm going in the hills. And my dad says, no, you're not going in the hills. I says, well, no, me and my buddy Tony, like I'm going. And like we had a falling out and I went. So we were in the hills, we're doing some jumps, and like, I tried this stupid jump, and I got Dean wheel spin. And I endoed, went over the bars, and popped my shoulder and broke my thumb. And all I thought first thing was my dad and Mitch Payne.
It's gonna kill me.
They couldn't have a worse combination. My dad and Mitch Payne. So I'm thinking, oh no. So we leave this PC 450 in the middle of the hills. My helmet and everything, and I get doubled back to my friend's house. We're Googling how to pop my shoulder back in. We couldn't get the shoulder in. So then we told our friend to go get my bike so no one takes it. So went to the hospital, and I remember like calling my dad. I'm like, oh my God. And I was like, Dad. And I told him, call ended. I'm like, oh no. Up? Yeah. Oh. He didn't speak to me for like 2 weeks after that. But and then when I called Mitch, I was like, yeah, so I was riding this corner track and like.
I was just about to say, how did you twist the story?
Yeah, I was like, I'm riding the, and there was just this one jump on the corner track and it just bucked me. And yeah, I think he wasn't stupid.
Then he's like, it's not a corner track then.
Yeah. Well, there was corner. We had to turn around to keep hitting the jump. Right. Yeah.
So I'll just always remember that. So, anyways, that was that. Got postponed to East Coast. I don't know. I think I got sixth because I missed two races because I was stuck in Canada. But
oh, that was the year you got stuck.
Yeah, it was a pretty good year. I got a few podiums and what else? Oh, Vegas was a good one when PC we went 1-4.
Yeah,
and we were all battling and
that
stuff.
That was a fun one. Awesome. Mm-hmm. They made a big poster of that.
Yep. Yeah. So that was cool to be part of. Mm. So and then outdoors went really good. Probably the biggest. Bonehead move was the second round of outdoors. I was leading, and I thought I was riding that good. Paul wrote on the pit board 5.6, and I thought I was riding that good. I thought I had 56 second lead. I'm not even kidding. I felt that good.
Yeah.
And I seen Rattray on my corner, but it was really hot that day. So I see Rattray on the corner of my eye, and I'm like, oh man, he must be a lap down. And like three corners before the finish, I let him by, okay? And then he does a big fist pump over the tabletop. I'm like, oh my, I realized what I had did. So I just broke into tears. Like I just lost my first win. But at that time, I still had the overall win. So I'm going through the rollers just like sobbing. And
scream crying under your helmet.
Yeah, my buddy Broc Tickle passes me over the finish line. And I lost the overall.
No way.
Oh my God. I seriously cried for 2 days. If you look at the podium pictures, 2010 Freestone, I was like, oh, it was bad.
I'm gonna have to go back and find some of those photos.
So I remember that. Two rounds later, I won Bud's Creek, and then was pretty good through the season. Then I won Paula, and then so it was a good year, Rookie of the Year and stuff.
Yeah,
that's a great year.
Yeah,
a couple wins, and then
yeah, really good. Yeah,
the following season, 2011.
Yeah.
Second in Supercross,
yeah,
and you won the outdoor title.
Right. So, no, it was a good year. Was battling, had good battles with Barsha and Supercross, and just made some dumb mistakes and crashed a few races. And then
I remember outdoors, that year you were Faust.
Yeah, and then outdoors just started off the first race of the year with the win. And, yeah, it was just good. I was just on the podium every race and rode really well. And yep. Me, Baggett, and Rattray were all just battling.
Yeah,
so.
That was a good year that year to watch. Mm-hmm. You guys were on fire.
Another thing I noticed about you over your career is you don't, maybe you can tell me if different, but like you don't seem to prefer indoor or out. You're good both.
Yeah, that's the thing is, I mean, I think for convenience, Supercross is,
yeah,
you know, just
tough to beat.
Yeah, you fly in, you drive 10 minutes to the hotel, the stadium's right there. Outdoors, it's you fly in, you have an hour and a half drive. Like it's more of a grind. Mm-hmm. But I feel like I'm good at outdoors and I feel like I can suffer in the heat. Like, I really like the heat, and I feel like, I don't know, I do well in the outdoors as well.
Well, yeah, so like mud.
Scotty Canadian who loves the heat.
It doesn't make sense. So, actually, I'm not really a big fan of the mud ever since my knees aren't the greatest, you know, so I don't like dabbing them
just
too much.
Just adds that risk factor. Yeah.
So
I hated the mud just because I avoided it my whole life.
Right.
We didn't have much. Yeah, so. Yeah. And if it did rain in South Africa, everyone's like, it's going to ruin the bikes. We'll just do this club race next weekend.
Yeah.
There wasn't any official. It was just like, I, okay, cool. Let's drink and then we'll go next weekend. The old man just wanted an excuse to have a drink.
So you...
Hey, look, is that the photo?
Yeah, that's it. I don't know if you can zoom in on my face.
Look at his face.
I think
like
I tried to put a smile on, but my eyes are really, really red because I was so sad. I don't look that bad there, but ask Paul, man. I was pouting. So yeah, Purcell got it. Rattray second. So I went from first to third in like 2 seconds. So it was devastating. That would have been $50,000 for me if I would have won that.
You know what they say? Sucks to be you.
It did.
At that moment.
It did.
Sucks to be you.
So
I do remember that.
Yeah.
Because I still remember thinking, why do you let Rattray buy?
Mm-hmm.
You were just crying under your helmet. It's hard to see.
I was sobbing. So
I don't mean to laugh, but that's pretty damn funny.
let's bring up all the shitty things that happened in your past real quick. And have
I
a
can
good
take
chuckle.
It. It's all right. I can know. Take it.
We know that.
It's just funny. All right. So the next year, 2012, how did that go?
2012, so came into the season, and I felt like I was just so expected to win. Like, everybody's like, oh, like, you had such a good 2011, 2012. So I came in, and I just had the worst arm pump ever and just real tight. I won. I started, like, bringing it back together. I got a couple wins, and then, you know, I was riding well. Then Tomac crashed in the whoops, and then I got the red plate back. So then I had that break, and then it was the last three West Coast. So I had the red plate for the West Coast, and then Seattle came, and I was like just revved up. I was like, I gotta beat Tomac. And then we battled hard. We kind of stuffed each other a few times, and then he kind of got the better of me. I got cleaned out. I put my arm out, dislocated it, and then I finished the race. But really, that was the end of the story because my shoulder went in and out and tore my labrum. So I tried to race the first round of outdoors, and it just wasn't happening.
You had to get it fixed.
That was the end of 2012. So,
well, how about that interaction with Tomac? I mean, do you feel... I remember that being a big talking point. Everyone was like, was that dirty? Were they just racing?
Yeah.
I mean, how did you feel about it?
If I could have...
Can you pull that up, Donnie? Can you see if you can find that?
No, don't.
That oh, he says don't. Never
that one still stings. That one, honestly, will put me in the bad mood, and I'm in a pretty good mood right now.
Just leave it alone.
you want
that one stings. I might have to. So...
this is your life is not going so well.
Yeah, no, that one stings still. But, with that race, I was just fired up. I worked really hard in that break, and just Tomac was so fast that year. God, he was like, he was just like, you know, like when you watch him sometimes, and quite a lot of times, but he gets like that just raw speed.
Yeah.
And he was like that whole year. So he's hard to beat. So I stuffed him a few times, and he just got the better of me. And now that I'm older, I'm not better at it. It was a learning experience, and it is what it is. Yeah. So
it's racing, too.
It is
you know,
racing.
At the end of the day, I always say...
I think just because I popped my shoulder out, I was so better towards it. You know, I think if I would have just got up, you know, it would have been whatever.
Yeah.
But I couldn't race the whole
cost you
rest
a whole
of
year.
Year,
yeah,
which was hard to take. So it's what it is, though. It's all a learning.
So
experience.
Then, did you got your labrum fixed that
right.
summer?
Yep.
How is that thing now? Is that the same one you just hurt again?
I don't even know at this point.
Okay. Is it in the same region?
Yeah, I mean, my labrum is, I got a very small neck in it, but it's not bad. It doesn't need surgery right
okay.
now.
Shoulders are good
yep.
structurally.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good.
You don't have shallow sockets, do you?
I don't think so.
Okay. We just,
we had
there's a guy
guest.
We know, yeah. Yeah, shallow sockets.
What about the following year?
So sorry. I just got to throw this out there. After Vegas, he's also got shallow pockets. Too soon?
No.
Oh, ouch. All right. I'm cut off. I'm putting myself back
going.
In time.
Somebody
there.
Get GL a coffee.
Up. We're warming up.
And we've had enough coffee.
Hey, let me ask you this. Totally off topic, but he's going there. What did you think of Cooper Webb's remarks in the press conference about Adam? Did you hear that?
I didn't watch it. What did he
yeah.
say?
Somebody said, hey, to Cooper after the race, you watched Adam the race before you go out and make a big mistake and then lose the title. Did that change the way you approach your race? And he just goes, no, he cracked. I didn't. Oh. I was like, oh. I mean, I guess it's true, but like that seemed pretty.
I watched. So I was at the race and I seen the crash, but I was from a distance. And then so I watched it on TV, and it's really a shame because if you watch, his rear wheel just lands in like a square-edged bump.
Yeah.
And it was like
such an innocent mistake.
It was like
yeah.
it wasn't even barely a mistake. I feel like it was just like it happened so yeah. quick. It was like I couldn't believe it. It was,
you know, sometimes when things go bad, they couldn't go any better. That was one of those. It wasn't even going bad, and it went freaking horrendous.
I was watching from behind the start gate, and I could see Adam's sister and Cincerello's entourage, and then Ferrandis's.
Oh, just the difference.
Oh, and I was watching both of them, and like. Cincerello, like the sisters just crying, and this is it's all emotional, like, and I'm like, can't believe it, and then I see them jumping up and down, like it was, oh man, hard, it's crazy. So
it was tough to watch.
Yeah.
I mean,
so
yeah
I don't know about that remark though. I don't know if he, I don't know.
Well, here's the thing too, I think sometimes and you're obviously a really nice guy, so maybe it's different for you, but I feel like sometimes when people say things like that in that situation, you just want to get out of there and celebrate too, and you just say, "Yeah, well, he screwed up. I didn't."
Yeah, but
so
man,
it could be taken.
You could, he could have just said, "Ah, you know what? I was just doing my thing."
Like, yeah.
You could have left that alone. That was a little jab.
Little jab.
No, they're not obviously buddies.
No,
no, but no. Man,
I'm sure they become friends when they both race 450s.
I'm sure.
Together.
I'm sure
yeah.
that'll
be good buddies. Yeah, good buddies.
You know, exchange addresses and things like that for Christmas cards.
Sending Christmas cards. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure Adam's not like Andy where he won't forget that.
Yeah.
All right, so you got your shoulder fixed. What about the next year?
So the next year, actually, off-season went really good. 2013, well, actually, no, 2012 was an interesting year because I was kind of over the 250 and I wanted to go 450. So I talked to Mitch. I had some really good offers. And I decided to go with Jeff Ward because I wanted to stay on the Kawasaki, Jeff Ward team. And I was promised to get factory parts, this and that. And the money was good. The bonuses were good. It was just like, oh, this is perfect. So I signed the deal. And then I started riding the bike. And then, like, probably 2 weeks later, I got the call that, like, hey, the team's, like, not racing next year. I'm like, what do you mean? I just got promised all these things. We looked each other in the eye and, like, you know, and I looked like a fool. And Mitch hired somebody else. So then I was like, what am I? So then I had to reevaluate what I wanted to do. And I really just felt stupid because I had some great teams offering me good rides. And so I hit up Mitch again, and Mitch was awesome, of course. So I was like, okay, I want to win you a championship in the Supercross because I haven't won one yet, and I need to do that. So started off the season, raced the East Coast, and won the first race, second in the second race, I think. I may have won the next race. Like, I don't know. I had the red plate.
Did he sign you up for the whole year? Or
Yeah.
He took you back even though he was full?
Yeah.
Wow.
And, yeah.
Didn't they have 5 riders that year?
Was dude, there was a point there were so many riders in PC, I can't even keep up. Like, Tyler Bowers was on it.
So Bones is saying 7.
Do you remember it at Comp Edge that day? There was like, yeah, it was crazy. So that was my deal. I was going to do East Coast 250, 450 outdoors. So I raced East Coast, battling for the championship, in my heat race at Indianapolis, I landed on this tough block, slammed the ground, and punctured my lung and broke ribs and fractured like something in my back, real small. So that was the end of that championship. So that was a tough one, and I got the tube in the right here, you know.
That feels good.
Oh,
huh?
Yeah. So that sucked. So then I did 450 outdoors, and I got two rounds in, and then had an unfortunate thing happen with the bike and crashed and popped my shoulder. So that was that year written off. So that
same thing, labrum, or what was it?
Yeah, labrum. So I had to get shoulder reconstruction, and that was the same shoulder. So I was freaking out that I got two on the same one. So got it fixed, and I never had a problem with it since. But okay. Yeah, that was 2013.
Knock on some wood. We're on it. Big wooden counter. That's why we got that. Knock the shit out of
so,
it.
So, yeah, 2013, not a great year.
Okay, so that was 13. Man,
and
that
that's what seems frustrating, like, for you. And as someone that got injured a lot as well in their career, I felt like if I wasn't injured and I was healthy, I was always fighting for wins, podiums, and championships. And then I'd get injured. And there was that whole rebuilding process. Yeah. And I've seen you have to go through that. Was there ever a time where you just were like, do I have to change something? Or is this going to continue to happen? Like, how do you think? Because I know for me, like, I was like, if I injured something over and over, I started thinking, shit, is this going to happen?
Yeah, no, constantly. I mean, when you keep having those injuries, you definitely start thinking about them a lot more, and that hindered my riding so bad. And so,
were you like getting on the bike thinking, I just want to have fun and not get hurt today? Because I feel like sometimes that's where riders get to when they start thinking, and then that's also that negative vibe.
Well, going in, so I got my shoulder fixed, and then so that was 2013 written off, and of course Mitch had my back again. I didn't really have a whole lot of options, and I still really wanted to just get that Supercross championship. But it's just the thing to think about. I was only on my fifth year as a 250 rider.
Yeah.
Dude, there's guys that are years and years into it, and I was only like 22, you know, so I wasn't even that old. But it's because I won so early on that I seemed like, you know, I was
a
older.
A veteran of the class,
right.
Yeah.
So it was only my fifth year. In 2014, I said, this is it, Mitch. I hired Rhino as a trainer, and like, just did everything in my power. And Rhino was actually really, really good at putting things in perspective for me. He just had a way of saying things. He's like, listen, you can't live your life in a glass cage. Like, if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. Like, because I told him, like, my problems and how I would be just thinking about stuff too much. I just didn't want to get hurt. I didn't want to do this, that. And we kind of broke through that. And 2014 was a pretty good year for me mentally and coming back. But unfortunately, I was battling for the title again with Anderson. It was me, Anderson, and Seeley. We're all kind of going for it. And I was leading San Diego, and I just made a bonehead move and crashed. And then Anderson landed on my bike and broke my brake caliper.
Yes.
Oh, that's right. I remember that.
Yeah. So that was all the points gone, and that was it. So
yeah. Now, so you hadn't hurt any knees at that point?
No.
He was just shoulders.
That was
you went from shoulders to knees.
Shoulders,
shoulders,
was
shoulders, knees, and toes.
No, shoulders was 250s. Knees was 450s.
Oh,
yeah. So yeah. So, so at Supercross, didn't win the title. I think I got second or third, and then so went outdoors and at Glen Helen.
Did you win a race that year in Supercross?
Yeah, I think I won two.
I was gonna say because it seemed like
Vegas, and I won Anaheim 2. And I should have won San Diego, but because
You've won like races in quite a few different years when you look back now.
Yeah, I was always battling for the title in Supercross, just didn't quite make it happen. So I think I've gotten second twice and third once. So
yeah, good results. Just it's tough to put it all together, right? I mean, many things have to come together.
Yeah, and I feel like a lot of my injuries sometimes weren't even like my own fault, which is always hard to take as well.
Yeah,
you know, so at least half of them were. So that's. But that's just part of the sport, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
Whether we realize it or not, when we sign up for it, that's what comes with the package.
Yep. Yeah.
There's things that you get involved in the sport, and you're like, I never would have thought about that, but that comes with what we deal with.
Listen, we're going to take a quick break. I have to pee, and this is going to be your Troy Lee Designs beer break. Also, the pee break. If you got to pee, get up and do it. We'll be right back with more Dean Wilspin. Right back.
Yeah. At Nihilo Concepts, we have a passion for innovation and for motocross. Our mission is to develop parts that will improve the durability, functionality, and the appearance of your motorcycle. We're proud to say that everything from Nihilo is made in the USA in our state-of-the-art manufacturing facility in Stuart, Florida. Whether you race every weekend or you just ride for fun, Nihilo offers high-quality, innovative parts that you just won't find anywhere else. Nihilo offers custom engraved engine covers, one-piece titanium foot pegs, brake tips, internal engine components, specialty tools, frame grip tape, carbon fiber components, and so much more. Check out our website, NihiloConcepts.com, and see for yourself why teams like Red Bull KTM, Rockstar Husqvarna, Troy Lee Designs, and some of the fastest riders in the world choose Nihilo Concepts. NihiloConcepts.com.
Another man of his mistakes. Too many cigarettes in my ashtray. Fate, I'm dying for its face. No point in trying to buy.
All right, welcome back to the Whiskey Throttle Show. That was our TLD beer break. Speaking of TLD, I want to mention a new helmet they've got out. If you guys have children that ride, this is the new Youth SE4 helmet. And something that's really, this is a Yamaha colorway. They make them obviously in different colors and styles, but something that's really cool and unique about this, a lot of kids' helmets are just an adult small with bigger cheek pads and stuff, and that's not great for kids when you start talking about size and dimensions and when they hit and all that kind of stuff. This has everything that the adult size SE4 has, the MIPS inside, all of the additional EPS in the kind of strategic contact points and things like that. It's crazy light. These things are amazing. Check them out. If you've got a kid, man, you don't want to skimp on a helmet. And we're going to get into a safety show here probably later in the summer where we're going to show some results from testing. There's been some other stuff printed, and I think some of it's baloney. And I'm going to show a third-party test that we did, and we'll name all the other manufacturers we used and everything else that show that this SE4 is the safest helmet you can put your head in. So don't skimp when it comes to your brain. So check out TLD, TroyLeeDesigns.com. We're going to get into something here real quick. We've never done this at a live show before, but we're going to ask, let you guys here in the audience ask our guests some questions. So we got our friend here, Brittany, going to run around. If anyone's got a question, raise your hand, and she's going to bring a mic on over, and we'll let you guys pick on Dean. Anything you want.
Dean just got nervous.
How's Earl, and will we see him again?
Earl is doing good. He's in his retirement home right now. He's just resting up. So we'll see. I think he does, you know, want to collect a few more championships that he's got left too. So I don't know. I mean, everyone's always asking if I'm going to do another video, but I don't know. This one, like the first one, it's funny how that all came about, because it was just, obviously you've seen Bad Grandpa and you've seen like all this, athletes do stuff. And, so I kind of like, I wanted to do this a couple of years ago, but just didn't have the time. So just me and my friend came up with the idea, and he works in Hollywood because he's a stuntman, and he knew somebody that could do all the makeup. So I paid like $1,000 for the makeup, and I was like, oh, but I was like, you know what, if we do it right, like it could be worth it. So it took like 4.5 hours to get the makeup done. And so we got to Pala, and I'm all makeup, feel like the biggest idiot, to be honest. I'm like, if this is just like, it was so hot that day. So we get to the front gate, and I didn't work like really on a voice or anything. Like I got to sound like an old guy. So the first like test was like the front, you know, gate girl
coming through.
So I was like, "Hello, sweetheart." I'm like, and she's looking at me, and I'm like, I just you had to act. So it was just it was funny, and then she went along with it. And then it's funny when I seen her like, you know, a couple weeks later, I was like, did you ever like know, think something was weird? And she's like, not really. And I was like, well, it's funny. You gave me the piece of paper to write down the date of birth. And I was like, I sat there for like 2 minutes trying to figure out, like, shit, how old
what
am I?
What year should I put down? Yeah.
So
am I in my 60s or 70s?
Yeah, so it ended up being, it turned out okay. So yeah, it was just a good laugh, something we did for fun. So for the next one, I don't know, it's hard to kind of top it. So we'll have to figure out a good game plan and do it. But I feel like everyone kind of knows Earl, you know? So don't know, we might have to be a different, maybe Earl's brother or something.
Yeah,
you know?
It's like you can't really do that same thing twice.
No, you can't.
You knocked it out of the park the first time.
Yeah, but. I don't know. I can't let any secrets out. No. So just stay tuned and we'll see.
Dude, what was it like putting that makeup on? Four hours of sitting in a chair, huh?
Testing my ADD, that's for sure.
Well, I saw the time lapse of it, and it did. It looked like it took a long time.
Did you worry that the helmet would take the makeup off?
Well, that's what was so sketchy about the whole deal was when I actually got on the bike, I didn't want it to rub the makeup off, so I took the cheek pads out. The helmet was just bouncing about. I just did the chin strap real tight, and we were hitting freestyle ramps and all sorts of stuff. So it was actually pretty funny because I went the week before and I had the vision in my head on kind of what I wanted to do. And so I was like, oh, I better hit these ramps before I do this because I can't just go cold turkey and hit a freestyle. Yeah. So I kind of had a lot more planned than what you think. But yeah, it was pretty funny.
What was the best response you got from somebody? The best part of it for you?
I don't know. Honestly, there's this one guy that was, this isn't really response related, but the one guy that's in it, and I brought the kid with me just to give me a little bit more backup so it looks a little bit more legit. You know how bad grandpa has his, his grandson. So the one guy that I said, what kind of bike is this or something, I said to him. And he was kind of being weird. And then I said something oh, he should be on the beginner track or something.
Oh, yes.
To this day, I don't even know if who the guy was. Or I didn't even, I feel bad. I would like to message him oh, sorry, mate. I hope you don't mind. But yeah, you got 8 million views now. So,
8 million people know that you suck.
Hey, if he's out there watching, it was all in good fun.
It was all good fun. So
either that or he's found a new sport.
He's got his
after Grandpa sold, Earl just sold. Called him out. He just said, all
right. Changed his number.
Sold his bike. He's done with it.
He's playing aggressive chess right now.
These motocross guys are dicks.
But taking the makeup off, I thought they would just peel the mask off thing, but they super glued it on and it was adhesive almost. So it took an hour just to get it off. So when I was done at Paula, it was so hot and I had almost a rubber glove over my head. So it was so hot and I was sweating. You push it and you could feel the sweat. It was all squishy and I'm just oh, I can't wait to get this off. And I had to drive home and then he started taking it off and it took forever.
Did you get claustrophobic in it? I feel like I would be almost smothered.
I was just getting claustrophobic hearing that.
I was just I wanted to rip it off, but I couldn't. Yeah. So
I probably would have.
All right, anybody else got any questions? We got a couple, one over here, one back there.
Yeah, don't walk in the
line. For 2020, the factory ride, do you have one?
Working on it right now. So I'm glad to say that I am in a lot better position than last year. So, Yeah, so that's nice. That's nice. We don't have to stress too hard on that. I think we'll be okay. So I think we'll be on a factory team for next year, which is nice. So yeah, working on it. Yep. Thank you, everyone. Appreciate it.
We got one way in the back. Brittany, you're gonna have to run.
Just curious, back to the Earl deal. Did they know that it was you, Axel? Did he know that you were out there riding as Grandpa Earl?
No, at first when I was riding with Cole and all these guys, they didn't know, but they kind of knew something was fishy.
he had, you see him laughing at one point.
Yeah, he's kind of looking at you sideways.
He's trying to figure it out.
He was trying to figure it out. And when I told him to go get something for my grandson, he's such a nice guy. He went back to his truck and got some gloves. And I'm just waiting there. And the thing was the thing that I wish I did, but I was scared to, was I wanted to mess with Brian Deegan really bad. But he was eyeing me up and down, and I didn't know how he'd react if he was going to fight old Grandpa Earl or not. So,
well, that's the sweet part about being an old guy. I don't think anybody would really punch an old guy.
You could kind of get away with some.
True, but and then just ride the funniest foot part in the that corner. We had the biggest laugh at, me and Colt. Had tears running down her face laughing so hard because when I was riding with him,
your neck starts flapping.
Yeah, the glue came off my neck and it was flapping behind him. So he's like, dude, this guy's neck's falling off in front of me. So it was pretty funny.
He's so old, he's peeling his skin.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, plus the turndown whip was not invented when that guy started riding.
I've seen some old school pictures of some old school dudes having it crossed up. Not sure if it was intentional or not, but
no, they were just crashing. They just caught it at the right time.
Yeah. So,
anybody else got one? We got one back over here to the left side. Last one here. We'll get rolling.
So after they pulled you off the team last year for Husky, and you fought, or you started the beginning of the season this year riding for yourself in DW15 and selling T-shirts and everything, how hard was it to get rid of, like, with your dad and everybody backing you and all the work that you guys did to jump onto Husky?
I mean, it was like a 50-50 deal, kind of, because the amount of work it was just to do the first, four or five rounds on my own, and those were convenient. That was like going to local races, really, you know, from California to Anaheim to Phoenix to all that, to Oakland and all that. So that was a lot of work and stress, and to think that we hadn't even gone to the East Coast yet in a sprinter and a trailer, and the first round that I did with the factory team was a complete snowstorm, and I was thinking, could you imagine being in the sprinter and the trailer? Like, I'm not even kidding, I think that's why I enjoyed being a privateer so much, was like when I was at Anaheim 1, it felt like I was racing the REM. I was sitting in the back of a trailer, like, with a little propane gas tank here.
I was sitting there with you.
Yeah, it was just like, it was just...
I came to your hospitality area.
Yeah.
And there was some artificial grass.
There you go. We had HEL grass.
And then a big heater.
Yeah. And did you have a beer too?
I did. There you go. You would have enticed me with something.
Yeah, of course. And I would have, So it was just very, like, laid back and... I just kept the stress down, and so I mean, my dad
seems to work for you too.
Yeah, but the thing that's so cool about the factory Husky team is that obviously I was a bit salty, or not even salty, but disappointed that I wasn't back on the team, and Bobby Hewitt really tried for me and Rockstar did, but they just never had budget for a third rider. So that was like, when I talk about a tough pill to swallow, that was like that big gulp, it was like, oh man, that sucks. So to go back on it was kind of like, well, you should have had me from the beginning, you know, but to take the stress off of my dad and everyone that helped was nice, because going to the East Coast and doing the Fuel Series, we could have did it, of course, but a lot more stress, and being on the factory team is awesome, and the factory team, like, they know how I am and the person I am, so we keep it fun, we keep it light, and that's just the way I like to work and roll. And so I think that's why I gel really good with the team. Mm.
And they did do their best to take care of you, right? Like, you were set up with engines and suspension.
Mm-hmm. No, they looked after me, you know, awesome. And I have definitely no complaints. I enjoyed it, and it makes a great story. And it is what it is, you know. So helped me get to where I am now.
Yeah.
I've said it before, though. This is what I'd love to see. You know, we talked about earlier the 250 class. They're trying to, you know, push guys out. And you got this pyramid effect, and it gets tougher and tougher. There's fewer rides or good rides. You look at MotoGP, Formula One, a lot of the pinnacles of sport, and there's the factory team, call it. But I'd love to see it, if they're going to keep these rules and push good guys out of a class and go, all right, you're all going to end up in this pool, have a system there as well. There's two factory riders at the moment on each team, so there's 12 guys, and you got 30 guys that probably should be on a ride, at least 20. I would really like to see, and I know Husky's a new factory brand, but I personally think that all these teams should have a basically factory-supported team. Like, KTM have that, and at times other teams have, but there should be these factory support teams that have a good program, a good home, good equipment. And if something were to happen, there's also a feeder system. Okay, that guy got hurt, we'll bump him. And there's a trickle
system. Just like Butler Brothers, but for every team.
Yeah. Exactly. Every manufacturer should be obliged to have a factory-supported backup team that maybe is privately ran with sponsors, but it gets full factory support. Right. You see it in a lot of other sports, and I think that's what we're missing in our sport.
The only way
you
get that to work in our sport is if Feld were to somehow fund that partially. And give each team, hey, here, if you run a second team, we'll shed you a little bit of this money. Even the good ones, like even the good race teams, they struggle to make a profit. It's a losing.
No, they don't. I mean, they don't make a profit. The factories lose tons of money sell bikes.
So,
but on a semi-private team, look at Pro Circuit. I mean, look at teams. They've been able to do it. You get that factory support and someone with some business sense. There's always that perfect storm. There's enough people out there. I think it just needs to be focused more on, in my opinion. That's my two cents worth.
Yeah.
That's GL's little rant for the night. I'm done. That was Mella. I'm cool.
That felt more like a $1.50 instead of 2 cents.
Yeah. Well, all right. Well,
you're welcome.
We'll get into that another time.
350-cent coins.
That's an interesting argument. All right. Let's get back to your career, Dino. 2015. Pick it back up there.
Okay. So 2015 was my rookie 450 season. Same with Factory KTM, with Roger DeCoster.
Hold on. When did you ride for Reed? Those couple of rounds.
Year before.
Okay.
14. And I fell in for Reed for 3 or 4 races.
You had some good rounds.
Yeah. Like, I rode really good, qualified fastest at Daytona, won my heat race. I think I was in second, and then I faded back to 7th. But I held strong for like 15 laps. But I rode really good on that bike. And yeah, it was good. And I think that's what helped me get my ride for the next year.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, so sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you there. 2015.
So yeah, 2015 was my rookie 450 season, and rode for Factory KTM. You know, just one of the best teams out there. And I'm not gonna lie, I kind of rode Cowies for so long. Going to an Austrian bike was a big bit of an adjustment for me. So I struggled a little bit. I only got 2 races in.
And you're not the only guy that's had that, right, by the way. No, I've heard that a lot from guys.
The feeling of a bike, of a Japanese and an Austrian bike, are just so different. Like, everything is different. So it just took me a while to adjust. And
like, should go back to 2001 and try to do it with no linkage and see how different
it
feels.
But even for me, I remember changing, going to a Japanese bike. Right. I was like, oh, it feels way different. This is kind of weird.
They've gotten better, though. It used to be way worse. But it is still different.
Right, yeah. So... it's really not a lot to say. I second or third round blew my ACL at the test track, and that was me out for 4 to 5 months. And then I raced the last 3, and I think I got top 10, and that was that year. So it sucks because
it's so crazy you came back and did the last 3. Most people would have never done that.
Mm-hmm. So
that's because for ACL, that's a really short turnaround.
Yeah, I think four to five months. I was.
Because it's normally like 9.
So I got hurt January 28th that year. So 2016, it was like, all off season, I was just hammering it. Was riding really good. I don't know, I think I got a couple top 10s. And then I won a heat race. And then January 28th the next year, blew my ACL. Same day.
Test track again or where?
No, in practice. Time qualifying at Anaheim 2, 2016. So I had a 2-year contract with KTM. I pretty much missed a year. You know, I was out for a year. So I just, then same thing, came back outdoors, but I pushed it way harder and I made the last 5. And same thing, top 10s, nothing special.
It's impossible to come back. You know, late in the season. Yeah. So hard.
Yeah, so that was hard.
Top 10's a good result at that point.
You're trying to get right. And I remember Roger and Ian pulled me into the office, and it's just like they're very serious people, and I just knew what the news was, and they pulled out the sheet of paper, and it says, "Listen, you've raced 12 races out of 40 something races, you know," and I'm like, yeah. And yeah, so that was a tough pill to swallow, you know, like pretty much not cutting the mustard. And I just feel like I never really had a proper chance.
Never had a chance, yeah.
So that's when I went privateer into 2017. I was on the Yamaha because same thing, no one picked me up.
Why Yamaha? Why?
So why Yamaha? I know why Yamaha. I went in to talk to Keith McCarty to ride for him. And I'll never forget this, but I sat in his office and he called me Steve or something. And I didn't
this is not going well.
It was not a good start. he didn't really, I don't think he knew who I was really. And I just went along with it. And I'll never forget though, he called me by the wrong name. And I just okay. And I just said, I really want
Were you like, do I correct him? Do I just act? dumb? Do I just roll with it?
Yeah. Like, I hope he doesn't drop a contract right now for Steve.
Nothing worse than being like, I would love to sign, but I'm not fucking Steve.
Dad, I gotta change my name to Steve. Sorry.
Yeah, so I was trying to write. I was trying to get a ride, obviously, and he's like, well, what about if you're like one of our test you can be one of our test riders. And dude, that was such a, I was like, dude, I don't feel like I'm that bad to be a test rider already. Like, I was such like a punch in the gut. I'm like, am I that bad? Like, he's like, well, how about like, we'll get you a couple bikes and then we'll, you know, you can test some parts for us. I was like, dude, I felt like pretty bottom of the barrel, honestly. Like, I'm a parts tester. So I was like, okay. So he supplied me with two bikes. And
like, what parts? Like, race team parts or, like,
no,
endurance testing?
I went to the test track and rode the race bike one day, all day. And I honestly, like, I didn't know what was really going on. I thought this was almost like a test try. I was riding so hard that day. And they're like, thanks very much. And then he paid me for testing that day. I was like a test rider. So I was like, damn, I was thinking, I was like, maybe. So anyways, going to Anaheim.
Hey, but you're still a professional. You're getting paid right now.
Yeah. True, but.
So you were full privateer ever. You just put your own deal together with these bikes they gave you.
Yep. Mitch was a good help. Had a really good close friends helping. They're a lot more smaller of a scale as a privateer as I did this year, like, because I learned a lot from this year. Like, for instance, when we was a privateer in 2017, all I had was a pop-up tent and a sprinter, like super simple. And I learned that you got to have barricades because there was like fans sitting on my bike while my dad's trying to work on it. And Andy's like losing his shit. He's like, dude, these guys need to get the fuck out here. Like, yeah. And they're like twisting the throttle and I'm like, my dad's like trying to work on it.
They're changing your free play. Like, oh man, I always wondered what it was like. Now I know.
Like, we had one 10x10 pop-up tent. There was about 12 people in it. But I was like, he's just such a stress case. Like, I'm like, I don't know. It was pretty funny. So that was one thing we learned, man. Barricades.
Yes.
So.
Well, because people don't know boundaries either.
No.
You give them an inch, they take a yard.
Yeah. So my buddy Casey helped too, and just friends. So anyways, I was battling with like Webb a lot. And I was like kind of in that 10th place area. And then Purcell was having a rough go that year on the Husky. He didn't make a couple mains or something, and something happened and he was gone. So Bobby Hewitt called me, and I remember that day I showed up to the track with my bike in the back and I didn't even bother unloading it. And the thing that was so cool about that phone call, it was, I want you for the full year. So I was like,
not stressing.
It
what
was
am I going to do
best.
Next month? Yeah.
Like, I was so happy. And
how many rounds in was that when that happened?
Four.
Okay.
Maybe five.
So again, kind of West Coast. You hadn't gotten
West Coast,
into the...
Exactly. Yeah. So sometimes I just from these experiences that I've went through in life, it's like I go with the mindset that it's going to work. Everything's going to work out. Like, just believe in it. So that was like my privateer deal. They're like, well, dude, I'll get to that. But like, I could have been on the factory team before... This year, I could have been on the factory team before the season, but I worked so hard on all my sponsors with, you know, I couldn't just bail on everybody. So, anyways.
And that's tough, too, because you have to do what's in your best interest. So you try and create this this avenue for yourself, and then you get caught between a rock and a hard place because you got the factory saying, can't help you, now we need your help.
Yeah. So 2017 was a great year. I got 8th in Supercross, got like a 4th and a 5th. A couple fifth places, so it was pretty good. I was healthy, made every race. Then outdoors, I got 2 podiums and 4th in championship. And then I raced designations and raced all these off-season races, so it was really, really good. So after that year, going into 2018, I was like fired up and really like, I was like, I had a lot different mindset where the year I went, you know, 17 when I was a privateer, I went in very gun shy and nervous, like I just want to be at every race. And then the next year, I was like, I want to like. You know, and it definitely bit me because that crash at Anaheim 1 where I just crashed so hard. And
that was a dirty crash.
Yeah, that was too much mad skills, that one.
Yeah,
so
you were fully back wheeling it, just
and I was doing it in practice so good, but I just didn't, made a bad mistake. So that was my shoulder injury, and so I tried to go the next weekend and I couldn't race, and then I rode during the week that next week and raced Anaheim 2. So my shoulder, I can, like, to get my hand on the handlebar, I'd have to, like, lift it up. But I could still ride. And, of course, that race was like...
Sounds safe.
Yeah, so...
Seems legit. Did you put free candy on the side of your van as well?
Put my goggles on, I'd have to, like, tilt my head and just, like... It was like my shoulder was so messed up. And then, just to make things worse, in practice, I was doing a qualifying lap, and I came around a flat turn, and I had my leg out, and it was, like, my bad leg. And I came around the corner, and the front wheel washed out of the rut, and it went... And I was like, oh, no. Like, my shoulder is already screwed, and then my knee now... And, like, I just kept it quiet. I didn't even say anything. I told, like, my close people. I'm like, dude, I think I might have done my knee. Like, I could barely walk. So my shoulder, now my knee. So I limped through the season. Started, like, getting – I got a second one race. And, like, just top 10 pretty much every weekend. Nothing special. And, yeah, so I had a bum shoulder and a torn ACL. So finished Vegas. Getting ready for outdoors. And – this is contract year for me, so I needed to make it happen. So I'm at Glen Helen Thursday after the week before the outdoor start, and I'm coming up on this rider, and he's like trying to race me, like he's not moving out the way, and like, so I get closer to him at this real fast section, and he jumps over and hit my front wheel, and I put my leg out, and my foot just punched the ground, and that was my good leg, and I'm like, it went, and
I'm
right away,
track.
I'm like.
At this point, you don't have any good moving limbs, right?
No. So like, at this point, I was
you have
like,
one arm that's okay, right? Is it this one? The one that you had two surgeries on?
Yeah, that sounds good.
His good limb is the one that had two surgeries on. Yeah. It's the only one moving, right? Because this one's wrecked, that's wrecked, and now you did side?
You sound like a standard motocross guy.
Yeah. So I was like, oh, no. Like, so yeah, devastated again. Steve, our team manager, was there. I was like, dude, I think I just blew my other knee out. It
my
was
good
not
knee is
very
not so
funny,
good.
Matt, at the I time. I hope you guys are enjoying this. This is a mean crowd over here.
That's what happens when the mountains are blue, you know.
Rough crowd.
You got to get rid of
rough
it.
Rough crowd.
Everyone's just drunk. We've run out of beer twice.
So. I'm just joking.
My wife's had to go to the store for beer two times. Babe, are you
Trooper.
Back?
Yeah, I see her.
I see her back there.
She's busy serving.
We need more
Stop
beer.
Stop interrupting her.
So anyways, I got MRI done on the knee, sure enough. Torn ACL, and then obviously my other one was torn. So
it was torn? You did tear it?
Yeah. So I got surgery on the one knee, and then the next week I got surgery on the other knee. So then I was just two knees like this all summer. And
it's not supposed to be funny.
No, I've had three ACL reconstructions. So I get it.
How do you have three?
I did the right one twice. Yeah.
Just
yeah, so I had the
all
bold,
three legs.
And I had, you know, the knee braces where you're not like, oh,
okay.
I had the lengthening ligament. Never mind. Anyway.
So, yeah, I had that leg straightening thing. You know, the brace where you couldn't bend your, and I just had the two legs like this.
You got pictures of that? Those would be good pictures.
Yeah.
Terrible ones, but yeah.
Yeah, so.
Okay, so that was 2018.
Scratched.
Done and dusted. Yeah. And that's
crazy to think that was not even that long ago either.
That was, yeah.
But that
was a year ago today, pretty much. Or this time a year ago.
Okay, so.
And that was probably a part of what made KTM and Husky collectively say, we're done, we're going to have private ride days now, right? That they just announced that.
That and then Jason did.
Well, then I was there when that lady came off the hill that was really scared of Glen Helen that set up there for her.
Did you see that?
Yeah.
You were there?
You must have rang your bell.
No.
I was one of the first ones there.
Were you?
Mm.
I'll podium the next weekend after that.
I know.
What happened there?
Because he forgot about all his fucking problems.
You forgot how many injuries you had.
Oh, yeah. That was...
Well, what happened? Do I know this story?
No. I was actually out there... I got a couple buddies from South Africa that are trying to do the national, so just working with them, and Dina was out there. And
Thursday practice?
Yeah, okay. Glen Helen. And they're going up Mount St. Helen, and I didn't see it in the beginning, but there was someone up there, but I guess there was some lady that had gone up. And that's the thing with Glen Helen, like, they almost need to warn people, if you're going to go on the main track, like, if you don't really know how to ride, it's not the day to learn how to ride. But she sat up there apparently for like 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm. At the top.
Trying to get the courage, because it is a big drop-off. I mean, it really is. And I didn't see the beginning. I literally saw the end out of the corner of my eye, but apparently she dropped down. but she was on the brakes so hard, and the top guys launch off.
Oh.
And Dina came off, and she was underneath him. And he landed, like, clipped her. And I was looking, and at the corner of my eye, I saw some carnage, and I saw bikes flipping. And I remember seeing Sam and them run. Yeah. And that's when I realized it was you.
Yeah.
You know who that was?
Scary. No.
Patricia Potato. Different gal, but similar.
So told her about not going up the damn hill.
Did you get hurt?
Because Jack fell down and broke his crown.
I felt like a train hit me, but I was okay.
You tumbled on the bottom. Lucky.
Dude, your bike was mangled.
Yeah.
There was a hole in the casing of the engine. So
yeah.
Somehow, like, so, yeah. There was oil and, like, the bike looked
really
bad.
I was doing a moto, and this girl was up there. She was like he said, scared to go down the hill. But I didn't know. I thought her bike was broken or something.
So you had seen her sitting there.
So you come at the corner, and then next lap, she's gone. I'm like, oh, finally, like, I can just launch down. And I launch down, and then all I see is
there
her.
There she is.
And I just, like, I try to avoid it, and then I clip, like, landed on her shoulder. Like, the top of the biggest hill. Yeah. And just boom, 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 boom. I'm like, not again.
Because
you fell.
It was
close
a couple years
yards.
Before where you went down on that hill and tore
I put
your
a
knee
massive
up, right?
hole in my leg. Yeah. Yeah.
That wasn't when you hurt your knee. That was a separate.
That
you
was like yanked. A gash.
Yeah.
That, yep.
So, but it was bad, huh? I heard. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So.
I remember your bike looked pretty rough. You looked a little rough, but the bike looked
rough.
You
and Christian Craig, not lucky out at Glen Helen.
No. So. I don't know. That was crazy. That was not my fault.
You didn't have run-ins over the years?
At Glen Helen?
I've had multiple issues there, too.
I guess I've gotten lucky. I mean, I've had some, but it's just a bad idea because there's mini bikes out there. Mm-hmm. There's
just
old
so
guys,
many different levels of riders.
Yeah.
And especially at this time, it's so busy.
It's this time of year. It's fine. It's not fine, but it's manageable.
Yeah.
Except for right now.
Right, getting ready for the outdoors.
This two-month window, it's like there's
all
the tracks should be doing
something. They do a pro day, I guess, or a pro section of the day, like 10 to 12 or something. So at least it's something.
Yeah, it's something. Better than nothing.
But you know, like half the intermediate raiders are going out there.
Yeah.
I've
that's
still
okay,
got
though.
It, bro.
I can intermediates fast enough to not probably be dangerous. All right. So your dad's been a big part of your career. Does he enjoy when you keep pulling him back in for these like privateer experiences? Or is he like,
No, he loves it.
I was going to say,
if
you know Andy, I would think that's what he lives for.
Oh, yeah. He loves it. He's just proper old school, you know, just like may not be the best mechanic. We'll get that bike together with some wood screws. But the factory mechanics are like, dude, your dad's working on your bike. And I'm like, dude, it's fine. Like, at the end of the day, it generally
when was
is
the last
fine.
Time duct tape failed? Yeah. Like, seriously.
Right? Yeah. Gorilla tape.
It's gotten better over the years.
That's hillbilly chrome. That's what Brock Sellers used to tell us.
Oh, jeez. Yeah.
Like, I'll get to the track, and my friends would be, like, checking over my bike. Like, I'm like, it's good. So, he enjoyed it. He really did enjoy it. It was a lot of stress, but this year I feel like it wasn't as bad, but,
Yeah, it almost seemed like he was enjoying the moment more.
Yeah, he was, because I just wanted him, like, to be kind of, like, I was calling him the crew chief. You know, just, I didn't want
it's
him.
Gotta
he
be.
Wasn't the mechanic. He wasn't, he just... Chilled, set up. He was like the truck driver.
Team manager.
Yeah, team manager, truck driver, you know?
Yeah. Crew chief sounds better.
Crew chief, yeah.
Sounds more official.
Yeah, so he enjoyed it. He likes bullshitting with people. That's his...
Yes.
More with the fans, you know? Yeah. I think he's got more of the fans than I did.
Oh, yeah.
If you don't know Andy, the next time you're at a race where he's there, you got to go up and just like... You know.
Half the people don't even understand him anyway, so...
Yeah. It's almost like you got to piece the sentence together. It's like code words.
Yeah.
Yeah, at Bones' wedding, he had a couple, and he was reminding me of how overweight and useless I am these days. And I was like...
Oh, he'll put you in your place, for sure, for sure.
Thanks, Andy.
No one said he wasn't a dickhead.
That's probably why we get along.
Sure, sure. Shoot.
All right, hey, hold on. We got to give this gear away. Let's do this real quick. Who has a... This is basically got to be KTM gear, right? Who has a KTM here? Ooh, lots of KTM riders. Who is a 32 pant?
With a red.
All right, we got quite
the
a few.
With a Red Bull.
Oh,
KTM
he's got a Red Bull KTM
there.
Hat. Yeah.
He looks like
a
32.
All right, you got the hat to go along with it. Come on up, bud. You just won yourself some gear. Sorry, he's walking in front of the camera, Donnie.
We go, it's buddy. All right.
Congrats.
Welcome. Yeah. Congrats on the gear. Just send him an apology about the camera issue, and you will be all good.
I got, you know what? I got a couple more things to give away. I got two free Dunlop tires. Who wants some Dunlop tires? It's a set. Oh, man, two sets.
That's everyone.
Everybody puts their hands up. All right, let's see.
Paul P. wants some.
We got regulars.
Regulars. Who? Who are you pointing at? Just tall hands. Well, how are you going to pick?
You I was pick. Trying to pick
here,
you for pick. You.
Rock, no, paper, oh. Rock, paper, scissors.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Dean Wilson here. That's yes. a good idea.
I like that.
All right, yep.
Dean, you yep. can hook
hey,
up. There we go.
How about a whiskey
throw? Literally. Hey, whoa. Come in front of the camera real quick because we'll allow this. Do a little pirouette for us. There we go.
Everybody
that's
buy
a true,
your Dino merch.
True fan
now,
right there.
Now pick somebody with a Whiskey Throttle shirt.
Okay.
Who's got oh, a Whiskey Throttle shirt?
There we go.
On.
There's our man right there. Come do a little parade.
Attaboy.
You're just as gorgeous.
Attaboy.
You sexy beast.
You handsome bastard.
Hey. Where? Someone get the man a comb. Get the man a comb.
Thanks, buddy.
Thank you.
All right. What else we got? We got more stuff. We got more t-shirts.
We
got
to pull a oh. raffle ticket, too.
What oh, do you yeah.
Do
let's
that?
Do it.
Okay. Let's
here.
Get that going.
Hold see on. How far you can throw that. Gah!
Oh.
That was a snag. All right. What
that's
do we got?
Why I
raffle
never played
tickets?
Football.
Should we do the raffle? What is this for? Oh.
I think it's for the wheels, isn't it?
Oh, it's for the wheels. We're
yeah.
giving away a set of Method wheels right now. Everybody have their raffle tickets still?
I thought it was a private training day with Grant Langston
oh.
and David Pengree.
If you're lucky.
Nobody wants that. Nobody wants that.
How to trade with Dean Wilson.
All right, here we go. Well, stay there
a private day with me usually means you'll end up in the hospital.
Or go to...
with a liver poisoning or something.
All right, if you got your tickets out, 618-601. Look at this guy. So pumped right now.
So quick, too.
Dude,
hey!
You just want a set of Method race wheels. Hey. Oh, thank you. Do me a favor. Write your, give me your info right here.
Yeah, that's our official.
That's his official form. should he put his or his mom's?
We're not trying to hook up with your mom. We just want your details, but throw your details on there just in case. You never know.
Oh, man.
Give me an email address. I'll contact you. And
maybe a cell.
Not your
just
mom.
Just in case.
Dad's going to be waiting yeah. outside in the parking right. lot for you.
It's all cool. Right. It's cool.
Hey.
We'll get you a set of wheels too, Dad.
Everybody's a winner here at the Whiskey Throttle Show. He just won bigger than most of you guys. Okay. I want to ask you how you got connected with Ignite. Because this guy, this Dan Bazillionarian, whatever his name is.
You got it.
Bazillionarian.
Yeah. You nailed it.
He's, what the hell, man? This guy's gnarly.
Yeah.
Because I punched onto his Instagram when you
yeah.
announced that, and I'm like...
Yeah, yeah, he's a bit of a character, for sure. So, how I got hooked up with Ignite was... So, I was at the AusX Open in Australia, and this guy, Eric, that used to work for Monster, was there, and I met him and talked, whatever. So, before the season had started, like, I knew I was a privateer, and I'm like... And I... When I was a privateer in 2017 with the Yamaha, I actually got offered a CBD deal, and I was real nervous and skeptical about it. And then I denied it, and it was really good money. And then after that, I was like, dude, that was dumb. Like, this time I don't care who's sponsoring yeah. me. I'm taking it. So
Donnie's dildos? I can get you set up with him.
Let's go. Pornhub anything.
A producer just started that, Donnie's dildos.
Yeah, Donnie just started that. Yeah. It's an upstart.
We'll get you as a business card.
Okay,
sure.
Thanks, guys. So... So yeah, before I was a privateer, Eric messaged me on Instagram, and he's like, hey, I'm working with Ignite now, would really love to have you part of the program. So I was like, okay, so we exchanged emails, whatever, and then, you know, just threw a big number out there, and he took it. So I was like, sweet, and, you know, he was like, well, why don't we have a meeting at Dan's house then, and, you know, we'll talk to Dan. So like, oh, shit, we're going to Dan Blazerin's house.
Did you know who
he was? Yeah, of course. Okay. So... You know, I pull up to his house. It's like huge mansion, like yeah. massive. He's got a security guard out front, in front of the gates, and you sign in this iPad, sign a, what's it, NDA?
Yeah.
Non-disclosure agreement. So what happens there stays there type of thing. So the gates open, go in there. You're not allowed cell phones, nothing. So I go up, have a big meeting with Dan and all them, and...
Was it just you guys? Or was there, like I just pictured, there was like 15
no,
girls in
no,
bikinis.
No, he was just chilling up there. Right. It's not
okay.
always
the shoot
like
just
that.
Ended. Calm down. Calm down.
It's like that a lot of the time, but not when I was there. So yeah, I was just like, I'm in need for the support, and I think, and I do use CBD. It's like I do use it every day. So I am like an advocate, and yeah, it just worked out good. So he was a cool guy.
Is he pretty cool? Like,
yeah, he's just a normal dude, you know. Yeah. Just, I don't know.
He just has a lot of money and
loves checks. So
did he tell you about his brother? His brother relinquished his U.S. citizenship. You ever say anything about that? No, yeah, it's kind of a weird deal.
What?
Never heard of it.
His brother relinquished his U.S. citizenship and moved abroad.
Because what? Where's he from or whatever?
They're from here.
Huh.
And yeah. He just didn't want to be a U.S. citizen anymore.
Huh.
And he was like, I'm out.
Yeah. So.
Oh, thanks for the stats there. All right. I didn't know that. Interesting.
There you go. You learned something new.
Must have been a really
today,
confused bastard. Yeah. But anyway, you know. So. Maybe he's in Jamaica, man. You know, having a good time.
The vodka's sinking in, everybody.
No, I'm just saying, man, where would you go if you leave America? Like, seriously.
Scotland.
What's that?
True.
Glasgow.
That's where I would move.
All right, so you have like this, you have a pretty interesting way of meeting different people. Like, your buddies with Marshawn Lynch. How does that happen?
That's actually another funny story. So, like I said, we're having the best time being a privateer. We're just like enjoying it. Huge fan of Beast Mode. So I'm like, I follow Beast Mode on Instagram. I land in Oakland. And like, Beast Mode's the type of person that like when you're, like, he's just hood. Like, he hangs where he's from, right? So I look at his Instagram and he's on a moped doing a spit Instagram story. And he's like in the hood in Oakland. And I was like, so I went to the Beast Mode store because I wanted to wear his jersey for open ceremonies. And we got talking to the guy. And then he's like, dude, you guys should go to his restaurant. He's going to be there. I was like, I'll go. So we go in there and like we're like the only white people in there. And it's all like fried chicken and stuff. And the Ignite guy hooked me up with his agent. And we're in like this group text. And I was like, hey, I'm coming to your restaurant, blah, blah, blah. Not stalking you or nothing, you know. So he comes rolling up and
on his scooter.
No, he it's actually kind of funny because there was like when we walked in, like it was me, my girlfriend, and my friend, and there was like probably six people that looked like Beast Mode, and we're like little schoolgirls, like, oh, I think that's Beast Mode. I think that's him over there, and then like it wasn't him. So anyways, eventually he comes to our table and he just sits down and have a BS and. I was like, oh, you know, it'd be cool if he came to the race tomorrow, but he had a signing he had to do. So I met him there. You know, I just kept in contact with him. And then he messages me, and he's like, hey, I'm in Seattle. I was actually riding at Milestone, and he called me. He Instagram messaged me. He texted me. I was just like, dude, why is, like, Beast Mode is like, when he calls Beast Mode pops up, I do feel good.
Well, he
cool,
did go in Beast Mode. He was Beast Mode to find out how to meet up with you.
Yeah, so... So he was in Seattle, and he knew the Supercross was there. So we met up at Seattle again, and then we're just BSing, and he showed up right when I got fastest qualifier. So I was like, a good time. So he just hung out all day and introduced him to everyone on the team, hung out in the semi, like, till the night show. And he was just funny. He's real funny. We were just like, I was like, so like, do you have a bike? He's like, yeah, I've got a 450. I was like, oh, okay. I was like, where did he ride at? He's like, right on the streets. I was like, oh, let me see a video. And he shows me a video. And he's like, I was like, no helmet. He's like, what's that? So, yeah, he just rides with the boys on the street. So, funny story. I sold him a Husqvarna and got him all decked out in like gear and everything. So, I'm going to take him to the track here one of these days. So,
that's great.
It's pretty cool, though. Really cool dude. And, yeah, just normal, nice guy.
One of my favorite interviews I've ever seen of a football player when they ask him.
The press conference?
I don't know where it was. He's like, I just figured out if you just run through a mother effing
face.
Over and over. Dude, that little clip, it is my favorite clip of any football player ever.
Nah, he's cool.
They just ain't going to want that.
Yeah. So he's retired now, too. He retired. So.
Oh, did he?
Yep.
It's a tough position to just play. I mean, just... I feel like 5 years just whacking people,
it's a lot of whacking,
yeah.
Grant. You know, whacking people.
I don't do a lot of whacking, but I did when I was a young teenager, but not these days.
Yeah, well, sure. Sure.
Little less.
We're getting there, folks. We're headed to that Twitch zone.
No, we're not.
I give it about 30 more minutes.
No.
Okay, serious question.
Okay, I'll try.
Your accent.
Yeah, you try.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when you first came here as an amateur, I saw some clips and whatever of you, and you didn't have an accent.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you move up to the pro class, and you're groundskeeper Willie from The Simpsons.
Right, yeah.
What happened? Were you like
hiding
it? Well, it
sounds way cooler like, anyways, so I just thought I'd run it. No, I'm just kidding. So when I moved to Canada from Scotland,
brothers
right?
Brothers and
I
went sisters to are natural enemies.
Look, here you are.
Like Englishmen and Scots, or Welshmen and Scots, or Japanese and Scots.
Listen. This is actually Andy, I think.
Brothers and sisters are natural enemies, like Englishmen and Scots, or Welshmen and Scots, or Japanese and Scots, or Scots and other Scots. Damn Scots! They ruined Scotland!
You Scots sure are a contentious people.
You just made an enemy for life!
That sounds like Andy.
That's Andy, yeah, for sure.
Minus the beard.
Yeah. Were you like... No, kind of... downplaying it because you thought
no so when I moved from Scotland to Canada and I went to school I had a like real thick proper Scottish accent right like I lived there for like 9 years so kids would just kind of pick at me and like oh say this say luggage say pencil and just like I just got just I didn't like that so I just started speaking Canadian and they stopped asking but then when I'd go home from school I would just talk normal like this to my parents right so then I just kept the Canadian thing going and then after a while I was like, screw it. Like, I just want to be myself. And so when I just talk normal, like, as this is normal, people are like, oh, you're faking an accent. And it's not. It's just I put on the Canadian accent because people understood me better. It's like when I go to dinner with my dad, it's like he orders something and they're like, he's ordering a chicken pie and they're ordering a steak. Like, yeah. It's just like so hard to watch. I'm
what
just like,
he
dad,
said,
like, I love you, chicken pie. And they're like, okay, so some calamari.
Yeah, it's so painful to watch. So, you know, it's obviously like not fake. My mom and dad are like through bred, you know, from Scotland. But it's funny, even like when I go back to Scotland, I go back every year and they're like, oh, you're so American now. So it's
pretty yeah, I get that.
Well, it's funny, I mean, to hear different guys like, I remember Brett Metcalf mm-hmm. when he first came over, full Aussie.
Yeah.
And then he moved to Florida or wherever for a while, and it just disappeared. Yeah. Michael Byrne, same thing.
Yeah.
You'd have never mm-hmm. guessed they were Australian.
Even GL's lost his
Oh, yeah, GL's
essay.
Full. Yeah,
but when I came here, I'd see people be like, hi, I'm Grant. And they're like, Lance, Frank, George, Peter, whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
So eventually I'm like, Grant. And they couldn't get it. And I'm like, Grant. Oh, Grant. Hey, man, welcome to America. Yeah. So I'm like, hey, I'm Grant. And, you know, yeah. So no,
that's
problems
like
out.
The same thing for me, I feel like.
But, like, look at DeCoster.
Grant gets you nowhere.
This is the thing that gets me, though. DeCoster. He's been here since 81. Exactly got the heaviest Belgian accent you could imagine.
That's like my dad, too, though. My dad's been away from Scotland for a long time, and it's just, I mean, that's one of the thickest accents. So getting rid of that, like.
Well, the Scottish accent is thick to begin with. It's like the Irish a little bit. But I also believe the older you are when you leave...
It's tougher to shake it.
Yeah.
You're set in your ways. The younger you are, the easier it is to lose. Yeah. My sister came here early, and she had the same thing. Everyone else go, where are you from? You sound funny, don't you? So she tried to sound American.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And now if you listen to her, she literally sounds like she was born and
no,
raised.
She does, yeah.
Huh. Yeah, most Americans, like, we like... It's, you know... Girls love it. I'm sure you never used that to your advantage, Grant. Like,
no.
Poured on the heavy, you know, Saffir accent.
Dean, your sister doesn't have as thick accent either.
Yeah, right? She does.
She does?
Yeah.
Did you sound a little stalkish right now?
I'm buddies with Matt.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, when she talks to us, it's pretty thick, but she doesn't. It's the same. She does the same thing that I do, and the same as my good friend that I grew up with. He lives in San Diego. When he's doing business calls, he's like,
yeah, man.
Yeah, he's
all
like,
good, man.
Hey, what's up, dude? sounds super rad. And then it's like, he's like, you're 18, what you doing, pal? You know what I mean? So he just like goes from both.
So you can fully just turn it off.
Yeah.
I get all my slang back if I go to South Africa. It's mm-hmm. like brew and boot and cheers and lekker and all that.
Lekker
brew. Yeah. He knows it.
Say something in American. Say.
I can be a Troy Lee.
Do it.
Yeah, man, we got some super rad helmets that we're painting up.
Oh, that's legit. All right. You got this super like fun, friendly, outgoing personality, and that's translated into a lot of fans for you. I mean,
right.
From your gear, like same guys that do all our merchandise did yours.
Okay.
Temecula t-shirt printers.
Yep.
You were selling a shit ton of stuff, you know, when it was, you were privateering it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that's like, is that something you work on? Is that just you naturally?
I think just the position I was in was a good position. Like, but I think Ralph Shaheen, like I told him, like, yeah, I've got merchandise going and like, you know, it helps a bit with racing and stuff. Like, that's how I said it to him on track walk. He goes, on live broadcast, he's selling t-shirts to get to the races. Hey, I have the app on my phone. My phone's just going ding, 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 ding. I'm like, all right. I mean, that's fine. So
thanks, Ralph. Just so you guys know, I'm feeding my daughters with the money we raised selling Whiskey Throttle shirts.
It's my kids didn't even have shoes until Adidas came along. We were that bad.
So whiskeythrottlemerch.com.
Yeah.
So I think I appreciate everybody that supports it though. It's awesome and it does help a lot. And
but not even just that, just people support you in general just because you're friendly, you're funny, you have some personality. And like we've talked about this a little bit on the show before. It's like, man, we the sport needs more of that, you know. Mm. Guys are so robotic and it's become such a business.
Yeah, I don't know. I think I just like to be myself. I like to have fun, keep it loose. Like, I obviously have a very serious side when I'm training, I'm writing. That's all serious. But same time, when I have that fun, outgoing personality, I feel like it does bite me some ways when I go to talk to, like, a team manager and he looks at me like, oh, like, you just look like you're having too much fun, when it's like, yeah, like, that's kind of how I roll. Like, that's what makes me tick. That's what makes me go fast. Like
I feel like I relate to that a lot.
Right.
And that was me.
I put in the time though. Like you can ask Bones. Like I always like just I never have a problem with putting in the work.
Yeah.
But I like to enjoy myself, be happy. I don't want to be miserable. So
But that's what we see a lot of. I mean,
yeah,
I don't want to lump them all into Alden Baker's camp, but those guys that go down there,
yeah,
it's almost like they don't have any fun. It's just work, work, work from the time you wake up till the time you go to bed. And then those guys they're miserable. Look at RV. Even Ricky, when he was there, Stu, when he was there, was talking about that on his last little video he dropped.
Right.
It's like,
it doesn't work for everyone.
It does. That's it definitely doesn't. Yeah.
And I think you had mentioned it once before, and if I can relate a little bit, is I was also kind of that guy that was known to have fun. So sometimes people didn't take that as like, you worked hard. And mm-hmm. I'm like, no, I worked hard, trust me. Mm-hmm. And I get that. And I remember you mentioned before, and you even said, and not trying to bring up old stories, but you even said, like, for you with working with like Roger DaCosta, you guys didn't often see eye to eye. And I can totally see that. Roger was like, he almost wants, I think, guys to look like they're literally consumed with racing and that's it. And if you have a fun time or a social life,
Ryan
it could be taken the wrong way a little
like
bit.
Kind of would ruin that for me because he was so dominant and him and Roger were like the same type of people, you know? So when I came about, I was like, you know, a bit.
Crack a joke, have a good time.
And it was very serious, which is totally fine. But, you know, I don't know. It was just.
But some of that, like.
Different strokes for different folks.
Yeah. Some of that, how you like to just kind of keep it light and fun in the pits.
Yeah.
It kind of takes your mind off of the stress
of
what's happening.
Well, I just think, like, yeah, I mean, I do stress with, like, stress and anxiety. Like, I just sometimes stress out so hard on stuff that I don't need to. And, like, that's what I was working on this whole season was that I could always be so fast in qualifying, be good in my heat race, then in the main event. My anxiety was so bad. So I actually had Jason Anderson's mechanic this year, and he was really awesome. Like, every race, we're just trying to come up with a solution to help me. And I went way back to my PC days. I wouldn't, because when you're sitting on the start line for a main event, you're literally sitting there for like 15, 20 minutes and you're just looking there. You're sitting there and then I just start thinking of every turn. I'm like, oh, what if that rut's choppy? I'm just like overthinking. My brain's just constantly loading. So what we did, like, I would just show up really late. He would take my bike, I'd pick a gate, and then I would just like listen to music and just like go way in the back. And then literally when the bike started up, I would come to the start line, put my helmet on, and then I'd go. You know, because I think just when I would sit there, I'd just overthink, and I tend to overthink. So
the anxiety would just build and build.
And it would ruin me. So it was just trying to find a solution for that that was important.
Do you know what I thought was interesting? kind of in that same realm is, did you watch the second Stewart, James Stewart?
I only watched the first.
The second one's really interesting. He talks about how he hated racing. Like, he would be so stressed out about, like, he had to win that it's like sitting on the line. He's like, I hate this. I mean, he was miserable. Mm-hmm. It's kind of sad. Mm-hmm. And I think it was just exactly that. Like, the anxiety and the stress was just building. He's like, and he had so much pressure to win. It was like a second was a total failure to him, right? It's like, what happened? But it's like, I think a lot of people deal with that stress sitting there. You, like you said,
well, a lot of
you're
riders,
waiting for that 250 main to finish, and you're just like, ah.
Yeah, a lot of riders are that sort of, like you said, ADD, high strung. So when you bring them in a high-pressure situation and go, okay, just chill.
Yeah, just sit here for 15 minutes.
And think about all the things that could happen.
Yeah.
Like, it's the worst-case scenario for any one of us. So. Yeah. I mean, I get that. Eliminate
when you're sitting in the stands, like, I wish the fans could get the feeling of sitting on the start line. Like, when you're sitting, it's so intense when you're sitting on the start line. Like, all the mechanics and the riders, like, everyone's dead serious. No one's talking. It's like the start line is just silence, you know?
And then all of a sudden they do this.
Yeah.
And the bikes come up and the guys are yelling, you got this. Yeah. And it's just
so
gets
intense. Like,
it's loud.
Yeah. It's I think it's something probably that you don't appreciate when you have it, and then when it's gone, you're like, damn, I missed that feeling. But, or no.
Is that
no,
what it is?
It might be for different people. Truly. I'm thinking about it. To me, I'm just like, that was stressful times.
Yeah, it's stressful.
I'm glad I did it, but I'm glad it's in the past.
Is that more stressful than actually being on the track?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, well, once the gate drops, like.
You're not thinking about, you're in your zone, and you're worried about you and your surroundings.
And how
right
fast
there.
Does that go away? I mean, immediately when you're
to me,
corner?
It was literally like the 5 second board.
It was gone.
There was butterflies everywhere, and the gate would drop, and it was just like literally hitting a reset button.
Yeah, yeah. But those 10 to 15 minutes was just like, I wonder if killing you inside.
I wonder if you took down like an iPad or something, just watch TV or something. You know, just something to totally
some
take
Family Guy.
something stupid. You know, like.
Yeah. Or The Simpsons.
Watch The Simpsons.
We could watch Dean Wilson while we get lined up to race against Dean Wilson.
Yeah.
I'll tell you that the only feeling, because I kind of miss that. It's as like sickening as it was and stressful. It also
makes you feel alive.
Makes you feel alive. Yeah. There's something to it. And the only thing I've ever found that replicates it at all is when I get a fire at the fire station. When you get a call for a structure fire and you're freaking, everyone's running to the engine, you're throwing gear on and lights and sirens. I mean, dude. You want to talk about adrenaline.
Yeah, yeah.
It's gnarly. It's the only thing I've ever seen that can duplicate it.
Yeah, and it's just the fact that it could go so wrong in the race. Like, it's what's scary. You could leave on a stretch, or you could win the race, or you could, you know, there's so much that can...
The outcome has such a
it's
variance.
Yeah, so...
Or it could just be a fifth place mediocre ride, and no one gives a fuck on Monday. I'm sorry. I rode pretty good, but... No one cares about fifth.
Right? Hey, from fifth?
Or sixth. At least fifth, they say top five. Yeah. But when you get sixth, you're like the best guy that no one remembers.
Yeah.
Sixth to 15th?
Man. I got six.
I've had plenty myself.
It's true, though. Sixth to 15th, no one even knows. Mm-hmm. You might as well just
hold
on.
You raced?
Yeah. Yeah. If you get 20th, they're
I was
like,
in the stand, but I didn't notice you out there.
Yeah, sixth is already automatically a top 10. Oh, you got top 10.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're like, I was really close to the podium.
Yeah.
Hey, let me ask you this. If it was up to you, if you had control of it, what would you do to make racing safer? We every year it's like a million injuries and...
Safer.
What would you do?
I don't know. It's hard to say. I think the bikes, like, they're so good and fast now. It'd be almost kind of cool if they slowed the bikes down and we didn't go at as fast of a pace, you know?
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I think...
That's something that we've
they do,
said. So.
If, like, the bikes were slower, you know, so is that it just wasn't, like... Because on our 450s, like, we're jumping quads and...
It's ridiculous.
We're jumping the biggest rhythms and sketchy stuff now, so...
We've talked about, like, okay, how do you... You got to slow it down. I mean, they've tried to go to, like...
The stadiums aren't getting bigger.
Yeah.
And that's what I keep saying. When you look over the years, they're covering the same amount of ground about 20% quicker than they were... In 2000, even, or late 90s. They were over a minute. Now they're 48 seconds.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a big deal.
I think they've taken and, like, mellowed things out a little bit to make it, that'll be safer. But now you're just going faster.
Fast through them. It's like the whoops. You know, you're jumping through them at the end of the night where the best was Seattle. Those big long whip section was
right
awesome.
Out of the corner. Yeah. Yeah,
and it was long.
And guys crashed, like Josh Grant.
Technical,
like a handful
but
of guys crashed.
People didn't get hurt.
That's it, because they were out of a turn. You weren't doing a million miles an hour. Where guys get hurt is where you come off a triple, grab like fourth or fifth, and you're going 60 miles an hour.
And remember, on like back in the day, in two strokes, you'd be running out of speed at the end. You know, so
yeah. Now you're not. Mm-mm. Once you get on top, you're good. But if you get a little out of control, then
So, I don't know if we're ever going to see bikes go slower. I mean, that's just...
I don't see it happening.
Not going to happen. What would you do to the tracks? Or I mean, what else could we do aside from that? Is there anything that you can think of that you can like...
whoops. Yeah. No, I just love whoops. It's my favorite. It's just... there's only
been... Damn tall guys.
Yeah, there's only been like three sets, like proper whoops all year. The rest are just jumpers and stuff like that. But I just think that slows the track down. I don't know. It's hard to say. You know, rhythm sections, it is, you know, if it was more up and down and not so forward.
Mm-hmm.
But then if you case, you know, it's... I don't know.
I would at least like them to try that. If you go back and look, late 90s, early 2000s, things were much peakier, which seems sketchier. You think it's counterintuitive, but it slows the foot forward momentum.
But here's the thing. Back then, the guys got injured a lot of times because two strokes had a bog or something. So they went away from that. And now the bikes have got to their point where now it's like we've done this.
Yeah.
And they need to... Yeah.
Yeah. One more drink and that's what your eyes are going to do.
Looking London, hitting Tokyo.
What else? Anything else you'd change about the sport? If you could, if Dean Wilson had a magic wand.
More factory rides. Bigger bonuses.
Yeah.
Well, we got to be realistic. I mean...
Keep it 90s.
Keep it casual. Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, it's supercross only. I like outdoors, but it's... Dude, 29 races a year, you know, you think of... My training program is I race...
It's actually 30.
Yeah.
You got Monster Cup.
Designations, you know, off-season races. Yeah. So... It's just, it's
they
non-stop.
Don't get cocky. No one's even picked you yet, bro. No one says you got a donation. Pump your brakes.
Sure. He's got three countries that can pull it. Right?
He's like playing. He's like, all right, here's my passport. So let's see. Bring me your deals.
Yeah. I just think other sports like football and all that, like they have such a good off season. And we don't have a good off season. Like
there isn't one.
No, there really isn't.
It's, every year rolls into the next
year. It'd be nice to have like a good 2 months where we don't have to do anything.
I wonder if Dean, when they're picking Disnations teams, does he call Roger and he talks in an American accent? Hey, Roger, you know what's up, man? Like, I totally want to be on the team. And then he calls Canada. Hey.
Nah, he'd be like,
hey,
I got
don't you know I'm available.
Yeah, I could ride for you. Yeah. And then he calls, you know, the UK
team. TV. Yeah.
Oh, bring old Billy McKenzie back up.
Billy Mack. That's it. Yeah.
What kind of mucker are you?
I got a whole bag of butterscotch candy. Hey, this is a funny story. The other day I'm in my garage, and I got a Husky 252 stroke and a Husky street bike that I own.
Oh, that's a good one. Oh, sorry.
I'm not done yet.
Okay.
And my mailman cruises up, and he drops something off, and he stops, and he's like, oh, Husqvarna. Ah, cool, man. He's like, yeah, my daughter's boyfriend races a Husqvarna. And I'm like, oh, yeah, cool, man. He goes, Yeah, he races pro. And I'm like, yeah, I'm sure he does, you know. You know, you always hear those stories. Yeah. Everybody has a...
Everyone knows someone.
And I'm like, cool, what's his name? He goes, oh, it's Dean Wilson. I'm like, oh, your daughter's Sarah.
Yeah.
And I caught him off guard, man.
That's so funny.
Your girlfriend's dad is my mailman.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
he was cool, man. We sat and chatted for a while. And you guys been together a minute.
Yeah, we've been together for quite a while now, yeah, so... Getting a bit pressure.
Yeah?
Yeah. Getting a bit pressure. So
it's
she's good,
though.
She looks after me. She's been there the good times and the bad times. So, yeah.
She's a good girl.
Yep. She's good. Looks after me.
So
does a lot. So.
You get a...
Wait. Hold on.
I'm trying to like...
Multi-year factory deal. Then we can talk about that, okay? Let's just pump our brakes.
All right. I won't put any more pressure on you.
Yeah,
I did tell him I'd keep an eye on you, though.
Okay.
I mean, he's delivering my mail, damn it. So.
All right.
Hey, on that, I never, ever tell anybody I knew anybody that was fast. So there you go.
Yeah?
Yeah.
How'd that work out?
Yeah, it's good.
All right. I don't know where you're headed with that.
You too.
No, we're not fast. At least you were honest.
What would... So, like, if you could plan it out perfectly, What's the next few years look like for you?
I think the next few years, I'm 27 now, so 28. So try and do like another, it's hard to even plan stuff out, honestly, like the way the sport is. But if I could just get another 3 years, 4 years, like full years, Supercross and Motocross, maybe do, I think the way Justin Brayton's got his program is pretty sweet. Supercross only, off-season races.
Australia.
Couple months off. Like, he does Supercross. He's in the Hawaii racing right now. You know, it's like a holiday as well.
Dude, he does the Australian Supercross series, mm-hmm. our Supercross series, and then 5, 6, 7.
Yeah,
and he's
making good money. So I think that's a great program. But I feel like a lot of people are going to start switching to that program soon. So I think that would be in my 30s, you know. Mm. So
those are tough deals to get, huh? Like, you kind of got to find the right team. He's found a good spot for that because they don't race the Nationals.
Yeah.
So it's
I mean, Moto Concepts is Supercross only. It seems like a good team. He's got the Honda deal in Honda Australia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And then, so.
I actually rode, I was at Milestone today testing a bike, and Chris Kiefer was there, and I rode his race bike.
Right.
Dude, it's good. It is really
Who's
good.
Whose race bike?
Kiefer's. He's racing for Moto Concepts for the first two races.
Oh, so a Moto Concepts bike.
Yeah.
Right.
So, anyway, if you're wondering how those bikes are, I'm telling you, they're really damn good. I mean, Huskies are better, I'm sure. But anyway, what do you want to achieve before you retire? What's kind of the biggest goal for you?
Before I retire? To be honest, like, some goals kind of seemed to have reached, like, a couple years back while I was injured and stuff. But I felt like this year really, like, brought me back to where, like, it started to make me believe more that I could do them. You know, I felt like this year I was like really getting closer to being up front and getting a win. Like, I feel like a main event win is my next step, because when I was racing at Houston, you know, I was like, I qualified fastest, three main events, and I went 3-2, and then I got fifth, the third one, but I came from behind that one. So like, I just feel like my speed was there. So I think that the next step would be a win. And of course I'd love to win a championship. I feel like there's a lot of, I battled with Cooper Webb a lot this year, but he just had a phenomenal season and rode well. But it's like, it showed me that, like, I'm battling with a championship guy.
It's not unreasonable to think that you could be that guy.
Yeah, I really do.
I agree.
And I just need to put it all together.
What's the difference?
Consistency. I feel like Cooper, and I feel like Cooper's a very good racer. Because if you look at all Cooper's qualifying times, like, he was 10th. 8th, 10th.
He's a gamer.
He's a gamer. When it came to race time, he whole-shotted his heat, whole-shotted the main, and led laps. And see when you're the difference between first and third off the start, from third to 12th, it's hectic back there because you're doubling triples. You're like, you lose so much time already when you're already starting up front. You're getting away from everybody. And obviously, I think his whole program is really good. And he just was awesome this year. But there was a lot of races I was the same as him. And but he was just there every weekend, and I wasn't.
And so what? How do you get that?
I think I got to get hole shots for one. Mm. I feel like I'm pretty good the first 15, but that last 5 sometimes always gets me. Not physically, but sometimes my arms will get tight, or like, you know.
So that's all.
It's a mental barrier.
It
as
really
well.
Is, and I feel like you start off good, and you keep getting those results, like. I feel like anything Cooper did, it just worked out for him. Like, you know, he was so confident.
When it's your year, it's your year.
You seen him, like, land on the hay bales with Tomac, and he just...
And then makes the pass.
Yeah, and then Detroit was a real funny one, because the first two races I battled with him, and I sucked the third race, and his scores ended up being a second overall. You know, everything just...
Yeah, like, it worked.
It was... Yeah, he rode awesome, but I just don't think it's out of reach for me to be there either, so...
No, I think there's a lot of people that would agree with you on that one.
Well, I think a lot of it could come down to, let's hear it.
I think pretty much everyone in here agrees with that.
So, do you think a good off season, if you can stay with this team again and just have like a good run up to it?
Yeah, no, I think so. I think, I learned a lot this year. And it just, like I said, it brought that belief back. Like, I went from beginning of the season, I didn't know what to expect. Was pretty close to winning Anaheim 1. And I was still consistent, you know, top 10, top 5, top 5, top 10. But to be up there, you got to start right up front.
Yeah.
And sometimes...
It's too competitive.
There's so many fast guys. Mm-hmm. Like,
That's what really helped Cooper this year. If you look at it, he, even on the days when he was not fast,
yeah,
he got the whole shot.
Yeah.
And went from first to third or something.
Yeah,
so but his worst there was even day, races when he was maybe the pace for a sixth or seventh, he got a podium.
Right.
So he literally made the most of every situation.
Yeah, and that was his bad days. And his good days, he would, he passed Kenny, he came from behind and he was just, he was on the move there. He passed him on the finish line. So he was the man this year. So
did you spend any time at Baker's Factory?
I spent like a full year in 2017 because I trained with Tyler Rattray for a good 3 years. And, you know, I trained with Tyler because he just trained with Alden and I wanted to be like, try that program. And it was really good. I learned a lot from it. And we did pretty much the same program. So Alden's guys would go out and do their motos and then they would come in and then we would go do our motos. So it was a very similar program. So, it's a beautiful facility they have out there. It's insane.
I rode just not the main track, but whatever that sidetrack is.
That's the Troy Lee track.
Dude, it makes you feel like an idiot. I mean, it's sandy and ruts and like, you're just making mistakes everywhere. Mm-hmm. It was really tough.
The thing that's funny, I remember in 2017 was like, Jason, Marv, and Zach would be doing their... I feel like I was missing someone. Who else was there?
Someone.
They'd be doing their motos and like Tyler would be lap timing them. And then I would go out and do mine and I'd be like 3 seconds a lap off. And at first I was really stressing it, but like those guys were like... They were racing like... That's what makes the Baker program is they're racing like it's the... Like the main event. You know, it's so intense. So, but then on the weekends, like I would be right there. It was just so weird. Like I didn't really have it during the week, but then on the weekend, like I was pretty close. So, but I think that's what so good about the Baker's Factory is just they're just every day they're just racing and it gets them comfortable with that being that close and that intensity.
Yeah, because when you go practice by yourself, you're only going to push so hard,
right?
You know,
and yeah, sometimes I feel like I don't push that hard because I want to stay safe. You know that. And those guys are riding
hard. It's a double-edged sword.
Right.
You push hard, you're worried about injuries, mm-hmm. and then get injured, you don't push.
Yeah, those guys, they just get pushed and become really mentally tough, you know, because I see all of them have bad days, good days. It's like boot camp all the time.
Yeah.
Have you given any thought to what you might do after racing?
No, I haven't really. It's something that's kind of scary because, you know, that time's coming and I don't really care what I do, but I just want to be happy after racing. I feel like a lot of people, when they're done racing, they get depressed because they're not the guy they once was. And I just see it a lot, and it's like a difficult path. And I just want to be happy more than anything and do something I enjoy doing and, probably have a family or whatever. So,
do you see that being in the industry, or you think you want to go do something different?
I have no idea.
No idea, yeah.
I don't know.
It's a hard question,
the industry is all I know, you know? Like
I was going to say, do you have hobbies? Do you have anything that you really enjoy that has nothing to do with racing?
Not really.
Sounds like you're going to be a team manager.
I like to send memes. I like to send memes.
Yeah. Where's mine?
I'll send a meme. I'll be a meme maker.
Not a mean meme maker. Just memes.
Yeah.
To me.
Nice memes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like funny ones. I want to.
That's
laugh.
All I do. Is send
I don't want to stress out.
Me and the boys. We just send memes all day.
That's it.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can make a living doing that.
No, I know.
Hey, win a couple championships.
Could,
the next
he'll
few
figure
years.
It out. Yeah. He'll be there the first
some,
guy to get paid for memes.
There's some stuff out there that like is making so much money that's like, oh, why didn't I think of that? You know, it's like simple stuff.
There's some guys.
Uber Eats, you know.
Well, what about like telling your kids you'll never make money being a video gamer? My kids are like, yep, look at this guy, Ninja.
Yep.
And I'm like,
yeah.
Now what do I say? Well, now what do I pull out of the barrel?
The thing that's tripping me out is guys that are just making a living making videos. Like little clips.
Yeah, yeah.
No disrespect to him, but Axel doesn't have to race, doesn't do really contests. He makes videos, and dude is getting paid.
Yeah.
Because videos get like, you know, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of views.
So well, he's not a racer now. He's a social media
Twitch
darling.
Twitch now too, right?
They call
Twitch
it
is doing the same thing now.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people. Buttery? Same.
Yeah, so what you can do is you build it really... I don't know if you guys have watched some Gary Vee before. You know, when you're having your bad days, you put some Gary Vee on or some Joe Rogan. I had to do it a couple of days ago. I was having a rough day, so I had to put the podcast on and get motivated. But what Gary Vee says is you build your brand. So the way I look at myself is you got to build yourself a brand so people want to buy
options.
Your merchandise.
Yeah.
And people want to, you know.
Hire you for this.
Yeah, like make it Alpine Stars, I come out with my own signature boot, so people buy the boot, and you know, you can make all sorts of money doing all.
Keep yourself relevant. Yeah.
Like McGrath is so good at that. Like I was talking to McGrath actually before I got injured, and he said, "Do you remember the big guy that used to walk around the pits, the big McGrath and the big face, the cartoon character? He would just pay someone to go take pictures with fans all day." You know, so he just was really good at marketing himself, and
it's easy to do when you win 7 Supercross.
Well, true, but he was doing what I'm saying is he was doing them both, and that's why he's still doing fun stuff at the age he is, and getting paid. So
we got to figure it out, man. What do you do for fun? What do you do outside of racing? You said you don't have anything you really love that's not motor related. So what do you do?
What do I do?
He just said he sends memes.
Send memes.
Oh, besides memes, is there anything else?
I don't know, memes are pretty fun. Don't know.
No golf.
No golf. Shoulders won't handle the golf.
Don't you kind of travel a little bit though? You guys.
I always like to travel about. Do some riding schools. Coach younger kids. Whatever. Last year I bought a little bike for a kid and gave it to him. And
I
just like to kind of give back and because. You got to...
Even your gas cards this year, whatever you want to call it.
We're giving the gas cards out, just trying to help out a little bit. So, I don't know, I just like to give back because I feel like you give back, you get something in return.
Yeah.
You don't know what it may be, but...
It's awesome, dude. No, truly. Hey, I mean, I think that's part of why you got
to return
was
to come on the Whiskey Throttle Show. So, that's
that
a really
Thanks,
big...
Yeah. I appreciate
you were
it.
Really rewarded for all those Thank kind you. Things you did.
Hey, one last question for you. When you're done racing, whatever that happens to be, 3, 4 years, 5, 10, whatever you can last, what do you want your legacy to be in this sport? What do you want people to remember about Dean Wilson?
Probably, I don't know. Hopefully they just still remember me. I don't know.
So you want to be memorable? Go win a damn championship. There we go.
Yeah, that would be great.
Or another one, sorry. You got another one in
you. It'd be cool to be the guy that, was the guy that knew how to enjoy himself, but still was a good-ass rider, you know? That'd be cool.
Fun to watch.
Yeah.
I think you're doing it, man.
I don't have a great answer for that, really, but just as if people still remember me, because I just know how fast people are forgotten in a sport. It's unbelievable. I feel like people already forgot about Ryan Dungey.
It's true.
Right? I just feel like I haven't even heard Ryan Dungey's name pop up in a long time. And it's unfortunately just the way it is.
Yeah.
This sport's brutal that way. It's your
if
career
you don't
is so
stay
short anyway.
Stay relevant and stay in it. You know, if you just retire, then
move
go away.
It's
crazy.
Yeah,
it's like being a tear off.
It really is.
Yeah.
Fantastic analogy, GL.
Yeah.
So
right.
You're welcome.
Well, listen, bud. Thank you for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me.
You're one of our favorite riders, and I think everyone sitting here in the crowd would say the same thing. So
thank you.
Appreciate you coming on.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
All right. Yeah.
Thanks, buddy.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, buddy. Good luck.
Thank you. Good luck
with the rest of the year and the healing up. We'll be rooting for you at the Nationals.
Thanks for having me.
We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back to finish up the Whiskey Throttle Show.
4WP is more than a store. We're truck and Jeep experts. From wheel and tire upgrades to full custom builds, 4WP has you covered. Do your rig right. Shop online or find your store at 4WP.com.
We'll be right back.
All right, everybody. Welcome back to the Whiskey Throttle Show. Big thanks to Dean Wilson, Dean Wheelspin, for coming on. Just a super good dude. Love having him on. That was fun.
Dean has always been a crowd favorite.
Yeah.
Likeable guy. Like I said, I remember the first time meeting him. Actually, the first time I saw him ride, I'd never met him. I met him the next time, didn't know what to expect, and I still thought, wow. He was very, I feel like an Americanized Canadian Scotty.
Yeah. 50-50-50.
Yeah.
Yeah.
150% full in.
You thought that.
Yeah.
What an Americanized Canadian Scottish man that was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, we got our four-wheel parts. Get at me Q&A. If you guys have questions for Grant now, you can send them in. Grant.
Did send I say, him?
Send did him? I say Grant?
Yes.
Sorry. I'm on the GL program tonight with a little vodka.
Just give him a second. Sorry.
Send them to our Twitter account. Why don't you share that?
@W_throttle_show. Boom. That just happened.
Or just a shit emoji. That also doubles for our Twitter handle. Donnie, what do we got tonight? Any good questions?
Yeah, I got a couple here. Who will win their first national between Anderson and Osborne?
I got to go with Zacho.
Yeah, I was going to say. I think just based on where they're at, you know, Jason's sort of, I would say, a little bit further behind the eight ball, and Zacho's a little more in the groove, and based on their history, I would think, but you know what? We'll probably get proven wrong. It'll probably be Anderson.
Well, yeah, anytime you make predictions, you're setting yourself up, but you ask the question. Here's my answer. Jason Anderson's never won an outdoor national, 250 or 450. Zach Osborne is the 250 national champion, convincingly. So I think he's, these last few Supercrosses, he really came on strong. Yeah. I think he's getting...
And he's in his groove.
Getting into it. Jason's been off all Supercross season long. He's still got to kind of get back into the racing thing. And frankly, when he was racing, he did not look great. So curious to see how he does. But
yeah,
I got Zacho winning.
But at the MX of Nations, he won convincingly at Moto. Anderson.
2 years ago.
Yeah, but still, he has the speed.
Yeah. He won the Supercross title last year.
Okay, you go Zacho.
And Anaheim this
you
year.
You go Zacho, I go Ando.
Yeah?
Just because.
What are we betting on?
I don't know.
Well, what
some whiskey.
Whiskey?
A little Whiskey Throttle.
All right. What else? What else we got?
Lee Davies wants to know, did either of you get to keep any of your race bikes when you're done racing?
That's a big no for me.
I've got a few, yeah. I kept... the one I wish I had, which I don't have, which we're trying to make a replica, is my 2000 World Championship bike. But I have my 03 125 KTM outdoor title bike. And then when I rode for Mitch, I made sure that was also in the contract. So I got my 05 and 06 East Coast, West Coast championship bikes. And what's cool with those is the 05 was the steel frame. The 06 is the aluminum frame. So they look a lot different, even though the graphics are similar.
Is it like... your race bike rolled right off the last race, or did he pull off the good parts and just, it's like a...
No, with Mitch, there were some internals that they took out and put stockers in. So it'll still fire up, but it's an exact external replica, but there were a couple parts taken out. Mm. Same with my factory Yamaha.
Do you look at it and go, yeah, it's not my real race bike?
No.
Be like, Mitch, get this piece of shit out of here.
Your factory Yamaha looked so incredibly stock, I couldn't believe it.
I know.
Like stock triple clamps, stock hubs.
I lied.
It's pretty much what it was.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie.
I kept my 2000 Primal Impulse Suzuki 125 because the team was going tits up and they owed me my last two paychecks. Like, well, I'm hanging on to these bikes.
Here's the bike.
And then you sell them?
Yeah, I did.
Bill's pipes?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. So I didn't keep them, but I kept them and then I sold them.
So you didn't keep them?
That's it.
But they were a paycheck.
Yeah.
All right. Brett Jones wants to know, how will Aussies Dean Ferris and Hunter Lawrence fare?
That's our Aussie buddy, Brett.
Yeah.
He bought us, what were those things? Tim Tams?
Tim Tams.
Has anyone ever tried Tim Tams?
Oh, my gosh.
Holy shit.
We also have a big Aussie crowd of you, too.
Oh, yeah?
Aussie!
Hey, you bite the ends off those things and drink coffee with them? Holy shit. It was so good. I can't find them here anywhere.
What?
I can't find them.
You're fucking blind, dude.
Am I?
Seriously, they're everywhere now. Like, Even Ralph's has them or something. Most places have them. I swear to God. I'll go get you a pack. I swear.
Okay, good. You're welcome. Just wanted him to buy me some. Okay.
I don't want to be the fattest guy on the show, so well, I'll buy you a few packs.
Hey, how will Dean Ferris and Hunter Lawrence fare?
Oh, that was the question.
It wasn't about Tim Tams.
Yeah, they'll do well.
It wasn't
do
Tim
well.
Tams. Anyway, the Tim Tams. Where can I find Tim Tams?
I don't know how Dean Ferris will do, but and I actually don't know how Hunter Lawrence will do, but I'm really excited to watch Hunter Lawrence ride. That dude looks fast.
He's good. I mean, you watch GPs. He showed just that raw speed. So an Aussie kid going to Europe doing that, he can come to America, and I think he can do very well. Dean Ferris, I think he'll do well. I just
didn't he do some? He did a couple races last year, didn't he? Fill in?
Yeah, he did.
Or jumped in?
Or the year before, he did. He was at Mount Morris, and he was leading for a long time. That was pretty cool.
I haven't really followed though how he did like you know this their past season, so I don't know where he's at in terms of health, fitness, speed, all that. But it'll be interesting.
Because Dean rode for. Factory KTM a few years ago.
He's only done one race this year? How'd that go?
That was in
all right, so the Aussies are telling us he went 1-1 last weekend back at home. We're getting all our information directly from the source over here. I don't know. It'll be interesting to see. And I think Hunter Lawrence, if he rides the way I've been watching him ride locally here, he's top five easy
How
all day
about
long.
At Red Bud? He was on it, right?
Huh?
Hunter Lawrence at the Nations?
Yeah.
Oh,
it was ridiculous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, kid's a real deal. I'm really excited
to
watch him ride.
I was there, and yes. Yeah. No, he's good. I mean, I've seen what he can do. The thing is, I guess, if you don't know him very well, I don't know if he's on a good program right now, if he's healthy, happy, but... Seeing him at the track just the other day at Glen Helen, briefly, like he looks like he's doing well. I know he did that Cal Classic, and he was on the gas. So I think he'll do very well.
He beat all the fastest amateurs in Southern California.
Hey, that's not easy these days. I'm telling you.
That's true.
But
yeah, half those guys are pro.
Yeah.
I think Hunter's got the most potential to succeed. I think for Dean, he might show some good speed and some results, but. If he wins, I think that'd be a shock. I think if Hunter wins, it wouldn't be a shock, yeah. if that makes any sense.
Yeah. That's all we got.
That's it.
Yeah.
Well, that was your 4-Wheel Parts Get At Me Q&A. Check out 4wheelparts.com, the number 4wheelparts.com, for all your off-road and truck needs. So our Decal Works last call, we went ahead and got a hold of Paul Parabinos. Parabinos? Binos?
I don't know if you have to emphasize the inos.
Dabinos.
I always say Parabinos.
Okay, well.
I just kept it subtle.
You keeping a soft J?
Yes.
Like yogging?
Yeah.
Okay.
I like to go yogging.
Paul was Dean's mechanic at Pro Circuit.
Yep.
He helped
when
him
they
again.
Won the championship?
When they won the championship. He helped him out again this year when he was putting that privateer deal together. They're good buddies. They've been together for quite a while.
Paul was a racer, became a mechanic in a Pro Circuit, top-fledged guy, left being a mechanic. Went a Pro Taper and
yeah, now he works for Pro Taper. Thanks for telling his life story, bud.
You're welcome.
Everybody now
kept
feels so much more important. So anyway, this is Pro Taper's Paul Parabinos. Have a listen.
Hello, Paul. How you doing, bud? It's GL.
What's up, man? How's it going?
Oh, all good. All good. Hey, man. Thanks for coming on the show.
Yeah. Right on. No problem.
Hey, so we had. Your good buddy and a friend of ours, Dino, in the house today. No, you guys have quite a great history. Tell us how you guys sort of hooked up. I mean, I remember you guys had some good times over at Pro Circuit.
Yeah. Dino's just a good buddy of mine, almost kind of like a little brother, I'd say. Just I'm really close with his parents and his family and him. And we met just when he walked in the C shop back in. Oh man, we're 2009 now. So, and it's just, we got along really good and, worked well together and really just became good buddies. You know, you hang out at my house quite a bit and, you know, when his parents had that issue, getting stuck in Canada, when Dean actually missed a race, we spent a lot of time together, him hanging out with me or living at my place for a little bit. Just like a little brother to me, man. He's just a good dude.
It is interesting because we always talk about in the industry that, you know, rider and mechanic is a very tight-knit relationship, but seems like with you guys, it's kind of even just more than that. It's a very tight personal relationship. And, you know, fast forward a few years, tell me a little bit about how and what and everything you guys went through getting that team together for 2019.
Oh, yeah, man. Honestly, to be honest with you, I didn't have a ton of work that I had to put in to get everything ready. I was just simply there. I just volunteered my time, right? So I've always believed in Dean, and I always will. And he's putting together his own deal. And if it was something I could do to take some stress off him and Andy and Sam. Sam is, you know, his riding coach and another good friend of Dean. You know, that, and we're all kind of good friends, right? We've all worked together for a number of years. So it was, you know, I still have a normal job, you know, dealing with pro takers. So I just simply volunteered my time on the weekend to help him out. And I just wanted to get him going. The goal was to get him back in a semi, you know, before he went east. And we did that. And, you know, he did very well. Anaheim was actually really close to being really, really cool, but I thought it was still pretty cool. But yeah, you know, just any close friend, I'm there for him, and yeah, he's my blind boy, and again, I'll just whatever I can to help him, I always will.
Yeah, that was I think a lot of people at Anaheim were pulling for Dino, and what you guys did was pretty cool. I know you said you didn't do a ton, but man, working a full time job and then having to get on the plane and do some of these events, that's some dedication right there. Fast forwarding a little bit, what are your early predictions for outdoors?
You know, I think it's going to be a bit slow to start in the beginning. You know, right now he's just trying to rehab his shoulder from his crash in Denver and try to get on the gate for Hangtown. And I don't know if that'll happen or not. It's, the shoulders are slow to come around, right? So, but I think it'll be a bit about him racing himself into shape a little bit. So I think the first half of the season will be a bit, you know, just kind of him getting his feet wet and trying to get his shoulder better. But I think by the end of the year, he can be, he'll be trying to get trophies again for sure. You know, he's just got to stay the course and you know, respect the process a little bit, because it's going to be slow in the beginning because that shoulder's still banged up. But luckily, it's not. It could be a lot worse. You know, he could be under the knife getting surgery and out for the rest of the year. So I think that was a blessing for sure because it was a big crash. But I think he'll be there by the end of the season for sure, back to the guy that everyone kind of saw in Supercross before he got hurt.
Yeah. Yeah, no, exactly. Anytime you can avoid surgery, I think that's a good thing for sure. Final question for you, Paul. Are you planning on doing any racing? Are you riding much? I heard you say you were pulling up to Paris.
Yeah, I actually haven't rode much since the little Glendale amateur race thing I did with Dean and his dad, actually, when we were out there for the Supercross or this, that. And I haven't been riding much since then. I haven't rode at all since then, actually. But just been focused at work. But I am at Paris today. There's a little industry ride day today, so I thought that would be a good opportunity to finally go riding again. And but yeah, I don't know. I don't really have any plans that yet. You know, I still try to dabble in racing a bit. I went to Loretta's a few years ago and did good there. And but yeah, I just, you know, we're getting old, right? We're all getting old. It's a good way to keep the pounds off, you know, and try to stay healthy. But yeah, so that's not top of mind, but kind of just working with Pro Taper and trying to, you know, develop product and keep things moving on that front has kind of been taking up a lot of time.
I can imagine. But, well, we really appreciate you taking some time out to come and chat with us here on the Whiskey Throttle Show, and look forward to seeing you this summer.
Yeah, for sure. I'll be at Hangtown, and yeah, I'm sure I'll see you at a few races. So I'll be listening to you for sure on TV as well.
Sounds good. All right, Paulie. Catch you later.
Yep. Later, Dan.
Cheers, bye.
Good dude, Paul Perabinos.
Yeah.
Been around the industry for a long time. And it's cool to hear his perspective on Dean. Those guys have been so close. I can't, you know, when you work with a mechanic, I mean, it's like a brother. You know what I mean?
I always say it's like a marriage.
Well, that's a gay marriage.
Yeah, it is. It really is. It's a gay marriage. But it's fun. I mean, there's no...
It's a sexless gay marriage.
Yes.
That's That is the weirdest thing I've ever heard. But anyway, still a good guy.
Marriage without the sex. How great does that sound? Yes, sign me up. I want to go back down that road.
That was brought to you by Decal Works. Check those guys out for graphics, plastics, mats, accessories, gay marriage annulment certificates. They have it all. Wow. Okay, I want to cover something real quick. I sent out a little post on our Instagram page. Free tickets from Decal Works to this show for the best slogans for the Whiskey Throttle Show. We've been having trouble coming up with something we really like that we want to stick with, so I thought I'd see what people came up with, and we got some good ones. The three people that won, none of them live around here, so they all said, oh, we'll give my tickets away because I don't live near there. I just wanted to play the game. But I'm going to share you their slogans anyway because these are pretty damn good. This is from D_Farthing. The Whiskey Throttle Show, make it a double. I thought that was a nice little double entendre, right? The Whiskey Throttle Show, because Troy Lee kind of wanted to own a bar. I thought there was a lot of truth to that one. And then this one, a little edgy. Again, I did not come up with this. The Whiskey Throttle Show, there's no pulp in whiskey.
Oh, boy.
All right. No hate here. We love everybody. Everybody love everybody. That's it. That's our show, man. I'm going to wrap it up. Call Grant an Uber, and we're going to wrap this thing up.
Now I'm just going to get me some pulp-free whiskey and enjoy my evening.
I want to thank PowerDot. If you guys have not checked out PowerDot.com, just do it, damn it. Whiskey Throttle gets you 20% off. They're awesome. Method Race Wheels, thanks to those guys. Such a cool sponsor. Troy Lee Designs, Decal Works, Dunlop, Four Wheel Parts, Adidas, Pro Circuit, Nihilo Concepts. Oh, I was going to show you guys something from them. I got a throttle housing. We'll do it the next show. They make some rad stuff. Check out NihiloConcepts.com. Really want to welcome our newest edition, Specialized Bicycles. So psyched to get on those things next week.
We are.
Yeah.
I'm pumped. Shit some LBs.
If he said, I'm not giving you the e-bike, you're going to have to just ride a regular bike, would you be as excited?
I would have said, let's look for another bicycle sponsor. Like, there's electric bikes out there. I'm tired of this shit. Like, I went top notch.
Oh, man. Well,
I'm in that commuter stage, like convenience.
Yeah.
I'm not here to, like, you know, break records. Only thing I want to break
is the bank.
You're
not
going to
win the Norba National Mountain Bike Championships?
You know what? With that e-bike, I have a chance.
Yeah, yeah.
One in a million, but I have a chance.
All right. Well, thank you to Specialized Bicycles. If you guys are in the market, they just make the best shit there is when it comes to two-wheel bicycles. So check those guys out. Thank you to Racer X, Paleo Ranch, Langston Motorsports. For Grant Langston and DJ Donnie, thank everybody for coming here. Appreciate it. That money is going to help guys who race and get hurt. Thank you to Road Recovery for their help. And we will see you guys next week. Take care.